This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Howie Klein joins us. He's the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, which raises money for progressive candidates around America. He also writes Down with Tyranny. Everybody should go there every day. What is Act Blue? What is the relationship between Act Blue and the Blue America PAC?
It's like the relationship between you and your credit card. It's a company that makes it easy for people to contribute to Democrats. So you can't contribute to anything else. You can't contribute to a Republican, but you can go to Act Blue and contribute to, through your credit card, you can contribute to any kind of a Democrat, whether it's progressive or Blue Dog or anything else. And Blue America was one of their very first clients. We adopted that immediately. And but now they've raised billions of dollars and everyone uses it. Obama used it. Hillary Clinton used it. And it's, Bernie, of course, it's used by every Democrat.
Okay. So there's a lot to go over today. In fact, today, Maine, South Carolina, and Wisconsin have some important elections, and we'll get to that. Five states are voting today.
The five states have primaries, and then Wisconsin doesn't have a primary till August. But tonight, they will know the winners of two special legislative elections, a state Senate election and a state Assembly election. They're very, very important, and we'll talk about why.
I want to ask you about Gavin Newsom, who is the Democratic nominee for governor in California. Dianne Feinstein is 84, I believe, and she's running for re-election. She's a senator from California, and she's got another.
I thought she was 184. Are you sure you didn't leave off a number? I can swear she's 184.
You know, in defense of Dianne Feinstein, she's been married three times. She had four names to pick. And she went with Feinstein. She's married to a guy named Bloom. She went with Dr. Feinstein's last name, which is a hard name to get elected to the Senate with. So she deserves a little respect there. I want to ask you who you're going to vote for, her or Kevin DeLeon. California has something called jungle primaries. They were instituted back in 2010 to encourage moderation. Right. What is the thinking behind jungle primaries? What is a jungle primary? Are they going to last? Are we going to see more jungle primaries in California? Or do you think they're going to get rid of them?
Well, it's not just California. There are other states that have them, too. They're a really bad idea, and they don't encourage moderation. They encourage stupidity. So, right now, because of the jungle primaries, there were 11 districts, but one got called, but there are now 10 districts that haven't been called yet, where we don't know. I mean, for example, Nancy Pelosi doesn't know who she's running against. Is it going to be someone on the far right, or a crazy Republican, or is it going to be someone on the far left? She doesn't know.
Does she know who she's running for?
She's so popular. I mean, I'm not crazy about her, but there were more votes and more people came out to vote in her district than any other district in California. She had 130,000 people who turned out mostly to vote for her. And, there were districts where they only like less than 40,000 people came out to vote. She had 340,000 people. I mean, we may make fun of her. We may think she's awful, but voters in San Francisco seem to think she's fabulous. Anyway,
so we don't know.
You asked me about Rohrabacher, the Orange County guy who Putin uses in Congress, and no one knows who he's running against. He came in number one, but there are two Democrats, who, I call them frickin' frack, Harley Rauda and Hans something or other. And they're going back and forth, seesawing back and forth of who has more votes. The last time I looked, they were divided by 20 votes. 20, that's it. Mm-hmm. And the Republican, a guy named Bau, or I don't know how you pronounce his name, B-A-U-G-H, he's only 1,000 votes behind them. So Rohrabacher has no idea who he's running against either. And like I said, there are 10 districts in California where that's the situation. Now, that's why I don't, that's not the reason that I hate the jungle primary. And I hate the jungle primary for a very, very different reason. It cuts out the party that doesn't win the primary in this big hodgepodge, which is why people call it a jungle primary. Other states have a jungle primary also, where everybody runs at the same time, but they then pick one Democrat and one Republican to run from that hodgepodge. In California, it doesn't work that way. In California, the two top vote getters, whether they be a Democrat or a Republican, doesn't matter. You could have two Democrats, or as you sometimes do, or you could have two Republicans, as you sometimes do. So it isn't really fair to either party, and I don't like the way it's been working at all. In fact, I hate it, and I think most sort of politically active people in the state hate it. But it was passed by a what is that called? An initiative. So it's very, very hard to get rid of. So what? I guess we're sort of stuck with it.
Did we as liberals want that 10 years ago? Because I remember in 2010 complaining that when a congressman runs for re-election, when he's challenged in the primaries, he becomes an extremist. So is this to create an atmosphere that discourages challengers or encourages challengers?
It doesn't. It just makes people mixes up people, whatever the theory may be. The reality is it gets everybody confused. Let's take, for example, California District 8. So the incumbent there is a guy named Paul Cook. So Paul Cook was up for re-election. He's not a very good or, he's kind of a backbencher. No one knows who he is. And
Democrat or Republican?
He's a Republican. And I think it's the biggest district in terms of square footage in the state. It's just gigantic district, very, very hard to campaign in. It goes all the way from San Bernardino's suburbs as far north, although not into Sacramento, but as far north as Sacramento, but it hugs the Nevada border. Most of it is desert, little towns and deserts and lots of mountains. It's mostly empty, but there are towns everywhere, and it's really, really hard to campaign there. Anyway, the Democrat who's running against him, Marge, what's her name again? Marge. Oh, I can't remember her name. Oh, Marge Doyle, that's her name. So Marge is a good progressive Democrat. She was running against him. But towards the end, this guy Donnelly jumped in. I don't know if it was toward the end, actually. Towards the end, he became apparent. He may have been running the whole time. And Donnelly had been at one time in the state legislature. Donnelly is so extreme that there aren't words to describe how extreme he is. He would sometimes be the only member of the state legislature to vote against something that everybody else agreed on. He's a racist. He's a neo-Nazi. He's the worst of the worst. But he just campaigned on Trump, 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 Trump. That was his whole thing, Trump, Trump, Trump. And now it's too close to call, but it looks like he's going to, it is too close to call, so we don't know yet. But he's leading Marge. So he's right now number two. So that means in the general election, voters don't get a chance to pick between Cook and Marge. They get a chance to pick between Hitler and Mussolini. No, I shouldn't really call Paul Cook Mussolini. What do you call? Well, I guess you call him Bush. He's sort of like Bush. You
get Franco. Like a Bush. Franco.
No, not that bad. More like Bush. You get between Bush and Hitler.
Right.
And so, what do normal people do? What do you just stay home for? You don't vote. I mean, you can't.
Right.
If you live there, you can't vote. If he indeed becomes the nominee, so that's the reality of the way this stupid thing works. Whatever they had as a theory, it doesn't work that way. It would work better if everybody voted in the primaries. But that isn't the way it goes, especially in big blue or big red states. People don't go out and vote because they figure, hey, I got a Democrat's going to win anyway, why bother? Or a Republican's going to win anyway, why bother? And then they don't go out and vote. And then you get these, instead of getting moderation, you wind up with exactly the opposite. You get this, you get a neo-Nazi running. And, if you'll notice, I don't remember this happening before, but we've got actual neo-Nazis running as Republicans this time in the general. You've got them, you know, spread out over the country, even to the point where Republican Party establishment is very, very upset. And they're not just, you know, one or two. There are quite a few. So, you know, that's, you know, if I want to know if this is if this is supposed to encourage moderation, it doesn't.
Right.
Although, to be fair, the other states that have it aren't necessarily jungle primary states. Anyway, I hate the jungle primary. I think it's awful. I wish we could get rid of it, and we can't. So we're stuck with it.
And there's another Donnelly who I assume you don't like, the senator.
No, I don't. He's a blue dog Democrat in Congress. He knew he was going to be defeated, so he took a flyer and decided to run for the U.S. Senate, figuring it would be, you know, kind of funny to just run for the Senate. He had no reason that he would think he was going to win, but he would, you know, he wasn't going to win his House seat, so he figured he might as well, you know, take a shot. And everything worked out right for him, starting with the incumbent senator, very liked and respected, lost to some crazy right-wing lunatic. So here you get Richard Lugar, who is one of the most respected Republicans in the Senate. He wound up losing his seat to a lunatic, literally a lunatic. So Donnelly was in shock. I mean, wow, what a great position to be in. Suddenly he's not running against a respected, revered, longtime incumbent. He's running against a lunatic. And sure enough, the lunatic, you know, started babbling a bunch of nonsense right off the bat, talking, you know, I don't know, like talking, I think he, I don't remember which was which, but I think he started talking about how it's God's will if a woman gets raped or something like that, something completely insane. And that was right. The end of his camp.
Yeah, the guy said that women make a juice that keeps them from getting pregnant when they're raped.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, the guy was crazy. And that's how Donnelly won in Indiana, which would be very, very hard for a Democrat to do statewide. Very, very hard. And Donnelly did it. And now he tends to vote very, very frequently with the Republicans. In fact, you know, there was a Supreme Court ruling today in which Gorsuch, of course, voted wrong. He voted, we should really talk about this next week, but he voted to allow Ohio to kick people off the voter rolls even if they missed one election. In other words, you miss one election, goodbye. You're not registered to vote anymore and you can't vote. And, you know, so even if someone, a friend of mine was just in a coma, he just got out of a coma. He was in a coma for 2 months, literally in a coma, couldn't speak, couldn't hear anything. He was out to the world for 2 months and he just came out of it. Well, he wouldn't have been allowed to vote. He missed the election. So now if he would go there in November to try to vote, they would say, no, you can't vote anymore.
Unbelievable.
So Gorsuch was one of the ones who voted for that. And I was thinking, you know, are you proud of yourself, Joe Donnelly, for voting to confirm Gorsuch? Because he did vote to confirm Gorsuch.
Well, in California, we have a gentleman named Gavin Newsom who's running for governor. And he's, I guess, running against Cox. Is that the Republican?
Trump is Republican.
Newsom was the mayor of San Francisco, and then he became, what, the Secretary of State?
No. He went from being the mayor
to lieutenant governor.
He wanted to run for governor, and it wasn't working out for him, so he jumped over to lieutenant governor.
Right.
So while he was still thinking he was going to run for governor, he called a meeting of all the political bloggers in in Los Angeles, and I was one of them, and we all met with him. And literally every person in that room fell in love with him, except me. Everyone, even people who I really admire and respect, everyone loved him. And he's very, very smart. There's no doubt about that. I mean, people would ask really, really tough questions, and they would then like realize that he knew more about the issue than they did. Guy's really smart. But I found him like sort of like slimy and greasy, and didn't like him. So, first of all, he's the mayor of San Francisco. So, how brave do you have to be as mayor of San Francisco to allow a gay couple to get married and perform that service on the steps of City Hall? And he, you know, acts as though, you know, he's the bravest person in the world, where it's not really about being brave to do something like that. He's a corporate Democrat with, you know, who's good on social issues and only wants to talk about the social issues and never wants to talk about what it is to be a corporate Democrat. He avoids anything like that, like the plague, and just wants to talk about easy social issues that he's good on. The other thing he avoids is talking about
single
the biggest scandal he's ever had. And my worry with him is that another one like that's going to come out halfway through the election, and we could lose that seat.
What's the scandal? What is the scandal?
The scandal was his best friend, who was his campaign manager, had a wife, and Newsom says he was drunk. I don't know. I don't have any reason to believe he wasn't drunk. But he had sex with his best friend's wife, and I believe it was more than sex. He had an affair with her. Maybe he was drunk every day. And he was married, and the best friend was married, and he did that. So I don't really care if someone does that. You know, it's their private life, and they can do that if they want to. How do you trust someone who betrays their best friend like that? That's a question that I have to figure out. And I would never vote for him anyway, because I don't vote for corporate Democrats, and I don't vote for lesser of two evils. There's no doubt that he's the lesser of two evils. And I used to support lesser of two evil candidates until a few years ago, and I said, hey, you know, I'm old. I'm finished supporting people that I can't defend, except to say lesser of two evils. I'm done with that. So he's the lesser of two evils. I'm not going to vote for him.
Where's he on Medicare for All? California, there are rumblings that they're going to have single payer.
Well, the reason we didn't have single payer before, it's funny, because I know you're going to ask me next about Kevin DeLeon. Kevin DeLeon is the president of the Senate, and he passed single payer. The Senate passed single payer. Jerry Brown, the current governor, flipped out, and he was screaming, I do not want this coming on my desk, because he felt he had to veto it, and he didn't want that to blemish his record. Mm-hmm. So he talked the Speaker of the Assembly into not allowing it to pass in the Assembly. So it never really got voted on in the Assembly, and that's why we don't have it. So will Gavin Newsom become governor and change that? I doubt it. We'll see, but I really doubt that it'll pass.
Interesting. Okay, so Kevin DeLeon is running against Senator Dianne Feinstein.
Dianne Feinstein. So where do I start? Do I start with Dianne or do I start with Kevin?
Start with Kevin.
Okay, so you are talking to someone who helped to recruit Kevin into running. He was unsure, although maybe he was sure by the time I talked to him. I don't know, but he said he was unsure. And I went out to lunch with him and, you know, gave him the spiel about why he should run. And, you know, I honestly don't know how much effect I had, although he says that I did have an effect. And I walked away from that lunch thinking he may do it. And then he did. I like him. He's a real progressive. He's, you know, a working class guy who came up from a poor family, and that is reflected in his of not just a voting record, but his leadership role that he's taken in politics. So you know, Paul Ryan also came from a working class family, but he did the opposite. He came from a working class family, used all the ladders that people from working class families need to rise, and then he pulled the ladder up behind him. That Kevin didn't do that. Kevin's the opposite of that.
And he's a Bernie guy.
No, I don't know that he's a Bernie guy. He has a lot of the same issues as Bernie. I'd never asked him if he was a Bernie supporter. He might have been. I just don't know. So now let's go back to Dianne Feinstein. I'm voting for Kevin. Let's go back to Dianne Feinstein, who I've never voted for once. So Dianne Feinstein, I think I've maybe told you this story before, but I was very close with Harvey Milk, and we spent a lot of time together. And he would come back from the Board of Supervisors meeting. That's like in San Francisco, the county, which has boards of supervisors, and the city, which has city council, were identical. So they don't have a city council. They just have a board of supervisors, or they did in those days. I don't know what they have now. But Harvey would come back from the Board of Supervisors meeting, and he would be, you know, flipping out and cursing and screaming And the person he would be yelling about was Dianne Feinstein, who was also on the Board of Supervisors. The person who eventually assassinated Harvey didn't like him either, but he liked him more than he liked Dianne Feinstein. So I got a I got my first introduction to her from Harvey Milk, who really detested her. So Harvey got murdered, and the same day that Harvey got murdered, the same guy, Dan White, also killed Mayor Moscone. So they were both murdered the same day, and Dianne Feinstein became the acting mayor, I believe, and then she ran for mayor. Mm-hmm. So when she ran for mayor, I already had a very negative feeling about her. And then a friend of mine decided to run as well, and I helped in his campaign. And the friend is Jello Biafra, the lead singer of the Dead Kennedys. I mean, not just the lead singer; he was sort of thought of it and wrote the songs.
Mm-hmm.
He did well in the election. He didn't come in second. I think he came in fourth in a huge. Huge list of candidates. And then she became mayor, and she ran for governor, and she lost. And then she ran for senator, and then she won, and then she's been a senator ever since. And I think she first won the Senate. That's why I said 180 years, because I think she first got into the Senate when Lincoln was president.
Right.
And she's been in there ever since. She's very, very, very conservative. And one of the ways that she wins every time is that Republicans are really happy with her. You know, if they have their own candidate, you know, they'll vote for their own candidate. But they're happy to just vote for her. They don't have a problem. She votes, especially in the past, she's voted very, very Republican. It's a little less so now, but not a lot less so. And right now, when she's up against a real progressive, she's, you know, minding her P's and Q's and trying to be much more progressive. But she never has been. She's always, you know, the last Democrat to get behind anything. And when you think about someone who represents California, it's pretty shocking that you have to drag her along on, you know, say, you know, gay equality. She wasn't there for that. Mm. She's not there for anything. She's always the last one to come on board with anything that's out front, which is why the Republicans like her. They're not going to get anything better in this state. And like I said, because of the jungle primary, there's not even a Republican in the race. It's Dianne Feinstein versus Kevin DeLeon. Now, Kevin doesn't have a good shot because you got to figure any Republican that comes is either going to not vote in that race, or they're going to vote for her. And the history of it, so this isn't the theory. The history of it is that Republicans do vote for her. They're perfectly happy with her. And then you've got the conservative Democrats who love her. She's one of them, and moderates. And, you know, it looks like Kevin isn't going to get much of a shot. He's going to get some Hispanic voters, probably majority, and he'll get the progressive voters, but she's got everything else. You know, I was buoyed the other day the California is divided up into Democratic Party districts, and one of the districts voted for Kevin. The leaders of the district voted for Kevin unanimously. So that was, you know, I felt good about that. But, you know, I'm not kidding myself. You know, he's really, really good. She's really, really bad. But, you know, I can't see him winning. You know, there's always a chance, since she's 183, that she will cash it in before she turns 184.
Will we see a vigorous debate between the two? Is this an opportunity for the Democratic Party?
Yes, I believe so. I don't know that vigorous is a word that you use to describe anything she does. But I don't know. I mean, will she debate him at all? I'm sure he's dying to debate. I'm sure he's dying to, you know, have debates up and down the state. I'm sure she won't do that. But she's got to debate him at least once.
And the heart and soul of the Democratic Party, is it ever going to be revealed? Or does it have one? Bernie.
Yeah, Bernie's the heart and soul.
Yeah, yeah.
And what do you mean, will it ever be revealed?
Well,
the Democratic establishment is doing everything they can to prevent Bernie from being the nominee. And, you know, they want to have some, you know, new version of Hillary, just another Hillary Clinton to be the nominee. And they're doing everything they can to make sure that that happens. So, you know, for example, well, they said this doesn't affect Bernie. I don't know how it doesn't, but they passed a rule at the DNC the other day, I think on Friday. Yeah, they passed it on Friday, that saying if you cannot run for president if you're not a Democrat. And Bernie is an independent. He caucuses with the Democrat. He supports Democrats. You know, after the election, he raised money for Hillary. So he's very much like a Democrat, but is he a Democrat? When he was first running for Congress, And once he even got in Congress, the Democrats always ran candidates against him. I mean, they would always find some conservative hack Democrat who, from the Republican wing of the Democratic Party, who would run against Bernie. And Bernie would beat them all the time, but Bernie had to beat both a Republican and a conservative hack Democrat. And then finally, when Howard Dean was governor of Vermont, he said, why are we doing this? This is bullshit. Bernie is more of a Democrat than these idiots that we're nominating. This is over. And he ended that practice. And then when Bernie ran for the U.S. Senate, the Democrats are smart enough not to run, you know, one of the shitty candidates against him.
Howard Dean knew Bernie because he was the governor
of Vermont. Howard Dean was the governor of Vermont when he called off, he called off the dogs. And he said, no, we're not running against Bernie anymore.
Right, right. Well, today,
the DNC is what they're trying to say now. It sounds to me what they're trying to say is, hey, Bernie, if you want to run for president, you've got to join the Democratic Party. And he's never done that.
And is he?
So I don't know. I mean, as far as I know, Bernie and Elizabeth Warren are running as a ticket. And I don't think the Democratic establishment is happy with that at all. They want a, you know, they want like some corporate idiot. And there are a whole bunch of them. You know, I think their favorite would be Biden, who's got a, you know, a terrible reputation as a Wall Street Democrat. And he has a long, you know, before he was ever, you know, I mean, there was a life that Biden had, a political life, long before he became vice president under Obama. And as vice president under Obama, he didn't do much except he was there. You know, Obama treated him well, and you know, he did, you know, do some things. But before that, he was a senator forever, and he was not a very good one. And in terms of, you know, he's the anti-populist. So he's probably their first choice. But I noticed today there was this whole spiel about, well, maybe we need a non-politician. Maybe we should go back and re-examine Oprah Winfrey and that coffee guy and Iger from Disney. And, you know, come on, give me a break. You know, we don't need, I mean, why? Because Trump is doing so well? I mean, Trump is a complete colossal failure. So let's find a Democratic version of that and see if we can beat Trump with that. You know, what a joke.
Yeah.
When it's obvious that the people want Bernie. I mean, not the dead-end Hillary supporters, but everybody but that wants Bernie.
Right. I do.
Okay, and I do too. So there we go. We agree.
Let's turn to the primaries.
How about Bernie and Elizabeth Warren together? Does that make you want that more?
Yeah, and Bernie would be the president. She would be the vice president.
I think so. I mean, no one told me that specifically. They just told me they're going to run together as a ticket.
Well, that would be the dream team.
I agree. That's what I call it on my blog, the dream team.
Let's talk about today. Maine, South Carolina, primaries. Five states are having primaries today, plus a special election in Wisconsin.
Why don't we start with the special election in Wisconsin? We're going to know the answer to that pretty soon.
Okay.
There are two... there are two seats. So the main thing that you've got to know here is that the hilarity of Scott Walker, the governor of Wisconsin, fighting to not have a special election. He doesn't want a special election. The reason for that is because every special election that they've had since Trump got into the White House, the Republicans have lost. Even in very red seats, and these two are not, but even in very, very red seats that Trump took by a lot, Democrats are winning. And that is embarrassing for Scott Walker. So he said, we're not having a special election. It's not so terrible if these districts don't have anybody representing them. And the districts didn't agree with him. And they got angry, and they took it to court, and the judge agreed. He said, no, you have to have a special election. And then what does Scott Walker does? He appeals it and goes to another court where the judge said the same thing. What, are you crazy? No more talk about this. You must have a special election. At which point, I mean, Scott Walker was thinking about taking it all the way to the Supreme Court, and then, you know, everybody was yelling at him for wasting the state's money on all these expensive lawsuits that weren't going anywhere. So he finally gave up and said, okay, we'll have a special election. So that is today. And there's a lot of, from what I hear, it looks really good for the Democrats. That both, certainly in the Senate seat, a Democrat's going to win. But there's a lot of thought that the Democrats going to win in both seats. And I know about these races you know, they don't make it into the papers. You don't hear them. You don't hear about them on TV. But the reason I know about them is because Randy Bryce has been campaigning for the two Democrats, for Ann Lloyd and Cal Enforcement. So Randy has been going to their districts and helping them raise money and, you know, using the celebrity that he has himself as the guy who chased Paul Ryan out of Congress. He's using that celebrity and that power to help Ann Lloyd and Caleb Forsman. So I feel good about these two races. You know, to quote the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, the biggest newspaper in the state, they said that what happens in today in Wisconsin will be an indication if there's a blue wave or not.
Okay,
I'm ready to accept that. So the rest of this thing is about these five states that are having primaries tonight. So that was in Nevada, Maine, Virginia, North Dakota, and South Carolina. So generally speaking, you know, Maine is pretty exciting. There's not too much excitement in the other states. I mean, Maine has got the most excitement. There's a little bit going on in the other states, of course. There's something. But I was very attracted. We'll get to Maine in a second. I was very attracted to, believe it or not, the Republican primary in South Carolina, just one district, because this is the district that always eludes the Democrats, but is always the one that could possibly turn blue. It's the one that includes most of the coastal area and what is the capital? It'll come to me in a second. The capital of South Carolina is there. Charlestown. So if you ever watch Southern Charm, that's where it takes place, and you can see those people are pretty liberal. Trump didn't win there by some gigantic margin. He got 53.5%. I think in all the other districts, he wound up with 70%. But this is it's reasonable to think that a Democrat could be elected there. So that as preface, Mark Sanford, the former governor who got, the guy who was like walking in the Adirondacks or something. The Appalachian Trail, right. So he resigned as governor, but everyone in the state knows him, especially every Republican knows him, and he's now the congressman from that district. And he was thought that, okay, well, he's in forever, but he's been relatively honest about Trump. So he's not one of these people who's, whatever Trump says, you go along with it. Did you see that picture, by the way, of Trump at a cabinet meeting putting his bottle of water on the floor?
And the mirroring of it?
By Mike Pence.
Yeah.
So Trump put his bottle of water on the floor, like Pence looked, and he thought, what do I do? And he said, I'll put my bottle on the floor, too. So he did. I mean, whoa.
Simeon says do this. Simeon says do that. Do that.
Yes.
I didn't say Simeon says.
Mark Sanford doesn't play Simeon says. So he's being attacked from the right by this state rep, Katie Arrington, and she's going after him. And her whole campaign is he's not loyal to Trump. We've got to be loyal to Trump. He's not the one. He's a disloyal never Trumper. We've got to get him out. It's an embarrassment for blah 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 blah. So there's a thought that if she wins, which isn't likely but could happen, we'll know in a couple hours, if she wins, a Democrat might take that district. I mean, it could happen. I don't say it will, but it could. Anyway, so I'm interested in that to see what happens, because the other thing is if Sanford wins, she's made it into a kind of a plebiscite so that Republicans in the rest of the country will say, oh, you can get away with criticizing Trump. If she wins, a lot of Republicans will say you can't get away with criticizing Trump, and they'll be too scared to do it. So that's another thing to look at.
Okay.
So the race that I'm the most interested in of all this stuff that's happening is the congressional race in Maine's 2nd District. And it's, although there are a few candidates, it really comes down to this guy named Lucas St. Clair, and I'll talk about him in a second, and the candidate that Blue America endorsed named Jared Golden. So Jared Golden is a young working class guy, literally comes from a normal working class family. And he, as a young guy, he joined the Marines and he sort of active, you know, he wasn't like one of these, again, not a, you know, a JAG lawyer who was in the Marines. He was a front line guy who was shooting, both in Afghanistan and Iraq. And he came back, and then he decided to go back to Afghanistan as a school teacher, which was pretty amazing that he did. And then he came back to Maine, and then he ran for the state assembly. He's now the second most powerful guy in the state assembly, as a state house, I should say. They don't have an assembly there. And he is the whip. He's the majority whip of the state house. And he's also the tip of the spear when it comes to any, especially when it comes to economic issues, any kind of progressive issue. I mean, he's the guy that's pushing. He's the guy that's making deals. He's the guy that's talking Republicans into backing a raise in the minimum wage, for example, or environmental regulations. I mean, he's always the guy that's first, getting the Democrats all behind it. And then, you know, there are some conservative Democrats. So then he'll go to the independents. Maine has like 7 independents in their state house, and you go to the Republicans and talk them into getting behind what he's trying to do. So he's just what we need for Congress. He's my kind of candidate, someone who's a leader. He's not going to sit around voting properly. I mean, he will, but that's not what he's about. He's a leader who can make things happen. He has a record that shows that. Lucas St. Clair, I don't even know how to begin. He may be a good voter. I don't have any idea. No one has any idea. He's an environmental guy. He believes in that. But mostly what he is just a rich kid. His mother, you ever hear of Burt's Bees?
Right, yeah. Yeah.
Stole it from the guy who started it. His mother is a real monster. And she stole this company and then moved it to North Carolina. So Maine lost all these jobs. And she's a monster. And her kid was, you know, born with a silver spoon or a gold spoon in his mouth. And, you know, what is he at? He doesn't even live in the district. He lives in Portland, where all the rich people live. And, you know, he decided to run, so he gets, you know, some kind of cabin that he can try to run out of. And it's a big joke. And it's just, you know, and he's got lots and lots of rich friends, and they put huge amounts of secret money into his race. And all these, it just really is an example of a richy rich son of a bitch running against one of us. That's really right. What it amounts to.
Right.
So I have every reason to believe that when all the votes are counted,
Golden.
Guy, I think I didn't even mention his name. Did I mention his name?
Jared Golden.
Yes, that Jared will win this race. I believe it. And then he's going to go on to have to fight the Republican who's already the congressman, Bruce Poliquin. And Bruce Poliquin is another, Trump-oriented guy and a Wall Street guy. He worked on Wall Street, and he's all about Wall Street. And he doesn't care about anything else but Wall Street. That's his thing. He doesn't do anything for anyone who lives in the district. He works for Wall Street. So the district is, Trump won it. The PVI is R+2. So in a wave election, there will be no red R+2s left. So I feel if Golden gets the nomination, which I feel pretty good about, he'll be able to wipe out Poliquin and become a congressperson. So that's the race I care about the most for today. The other race, though, that people are very excited about is replacing Paul LePage. LePage was termed out. He can't run for governor again. And so there's like something like 7 Democrats and 5 Republicans. It's a real zoo. But the Democratic front runner is the state attorney general, Janet Mills. And, you know, although there are others that have a chance of running a serious campaign, it looks like she's going to get it tonight. The Republicans have a bunch of people, too, but their front runner pulled out. So that's bad for them. I mean, the only guy who is really known statewide is no longer in the race. So they're in trouble. And, the other thing that people, you know, when you get into Nerdville, the other thing that's really important to people is the state Senate. The state Senate, the Republicans have one more vote than the Democrats. So if the Democrats can flip one seat, they'll have control of the state Senate. They already have control of the state House, and if they elect a Democratic governor, which looks likely, and they get control of the state Senate, they will be able to cure a lot of the ailments that Trump, that Maine has because of all these years of having LePage as governor with a pretty Republican legislature. So that's people are looking for that too. And they're, you know, it's hard to say what's going to happen. A lot of Democrats won in districts that Trump won, including in districts that Trump won by a landslide. So there's some worry there. But on the other hand, there are some Republicans that won in districts that Clinton won. So, you know, it's hard to make that call now. I don't think we're going to know tonight. I think we won't know till tomorrow what happens.
You're going to miss LePage, right?
Sorry?
You're going to miss LePage, Governor LePage. He was a good man.
I will not miss LePage.
Good racist.
I hope you never see LePage again, as a matter of fact.
And anything in Nevada that we should be watching out for?
I mean, yes, but I don't think that there's anything in Nevada that's really... that we can look to for any good news. I think the DCCC has their candidates, and they're going to probably win. You know, it's funny. One of them is just awful. She's just so bad. First of all, the mafia is behind her. The mafia is very powerful in Las Vegas because of the casinos.
I hope it's who you're talking about. Go ahead. Who is this?
Susie Lee.
Oh, okay. Somebody else. Go ahead.
Okay, so Susie Lee, the Democratic Party rejected her last time. You know, the Democratic establishment, which is sort of personified in Harry Reid, they rejected her. She's very, very, very wealthy, so Democrats usually want the wealthy one, but they didn't want her because she's so awful. She's a multimillionaire, and generally described as a socialite. Mm. You know, is that a thing that you put on a resume that you're a socialite and you're running for Congress? So this time they did something. You know, they're trying to rename or rebrand all their horrible candidates. So you know, one of the guys who won in California, he's a guy who fought against. He's as a lawyer, he's an attorney, and his whole attorney's practice has been fighting environmental groups on behalf of. Oil companies. That's how he got rich, by working for oil companies to beat down environmental organizations. So what is the DCCC calling him? An environmental attorney. Literally, that is literally what they talk to.
Wow.
When they talk about him, that's what they say. And then when they go to the media, especially the Washington-based media, they just the DCCC's media shop. Will say yes. He's a San Diego-based environmental attorney, and these people in the media in Washington, they know nothing. I mean, literally nothing, and they don't even know how to use Google so they could check it out. And they'll all repeat what the DCCC says, and they'll refer to this guy Mike Levin as an environmental attorney. They have the same situation in Colorado, where they've got a guy who has spent his whole life. Trying to help payday lenders. That's what he does. I mean, other bad people too, but he's known as the guy who helps payday lenders. So the DCCC has decided to rebrand him as an attorney who fights for poor people in the working class. He fights against them. He doesn't fight for them.
Mom and pop bankers.
Yeah, exactly. Mom and pop bankers. So that's what they do.
Right.
And in the case of this Susie Lee in Las Vegas, they're no more socialite. She's now known as a philanthropist.
Yeah. Well,
the same thing in Orange County, by the way. Another one of their dreadful candidates, what's his name? Cisneros, Gil Cisneros. He also was generally being referred to as the guy who won the lottery. Which is the only thing. I mean, the other thing you call him is a potato chip taster, but he was a potato chip taster for Frito-Lays, and then he won the lottery, and he doesn't taste potato chips anymore. I mean, he may in his own home, but that's not his occupation anymore. So he was widely known as the lottery winner, and the DCCC just changed that into philanthropist. So that's their new thing. Anyone who's worth millions or hundreds of millions of dollars, they're being called philanthropists.
Lucky bastard.
And I'm sure they donate money.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, I donate money. No one ever called me a philanthropist.
Howie.
But, so Susie Lee, you know, she will find out tonight if she gets it. But my guess is she will. You know, she's awful. Harry Reid is backing her. The DCCC is backing her. I think all their candidates are going to win. I don't think there's going to be a case of anything. You know, there are good candidates running in every district, but I don't think any of them are going to win.
Great. Howie Klein is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC. And
is that like how you say goodbye to me?
No, just wanted to remind you who you are. Sometimes as we're getting older, you know, we forget.
Goodbye.
We can keep going. I don't want to be piggish with you.
No, I have something to do now. I you know, like to count these votes as they come in. It's meaningful exercise for me.
Okay. We missed you last week.
Yes, it was odd because you didn't call, and I was wondering what happened.
I sent you an email.
Nope.
Yes, I did.
I got an email from you saying that you're going to do it, right? And I wrote back and said yes, and then you weren't there.
Oh, no, I sent a group email out. We're airing our dirty laundry here, Howie.
Right, let's not, because it doesn't matter. And
well, I'm sorry if you didn't get the email. I had a last-minute meeting that I had to get to.
You know what else I wanted to talk about? We can't do it tonight, but maybe we can do it next time. I just, because I think she's a friend of yours. Paula Poundstone, is she a friend of yours?
Well, I love Paula Poundstone. She's a great comedian. Yeah.
So, yes, and Ted Lieu had a fundraiser yesterday, which was really fun. His fundraisers are so great, by the way. If anyone is hearing me who could get to a Ted Lieu fundraiser, they are hilarious and so much fun. I mean, especially the question and answers time, someone asked him if he's seen the pee-pee tape, and he said, I will neither confirm nor deny.
Well,
but he is a riot.
Somebody named Lieu should know about the pee-pee tape. Lieu. L-O-O. Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
In any case, I auctioned off some artwork by one of the people who does the Down with Tyranny art, Nancy. And someone who won it was one of the pieces was Paula Poundstone, and it was a great piece. And there was, like, you know, 10 people bidding, and Paula outbid them, and she got it.
Paula Poundstone should perform at these fundraisers. That's
I agree.
Yeah, she's a San Francisco classic. She really is. And you had an amazing dinner last week that you wanted to tell me about.
So many amazing dinners since then, so I can't even remember which one it was. But the other thing is that Ted Lieu's next fundraiser, and these aren't for him, by the way. He's not doing fundraisers for himself. These are all fundraisers for the 2018 candidates. That's who this is for. He organizes, like, he's going to have 8 candidates at his fundraiser next time. It's in July. And all the money goes to them. 0 goes to him. So he puts them together, and this is going to be a great one. I mean, all the people who are, I shouldn't say all the people, but lots and lots of famous people. And I noticed Lindsey Buckingham, late of Fleetwood Mac, is going to be performing, which makes me really excited because he's, you know, tremendously talented and someone who I worked with when I was at Reprise. Mm-hmm. On that note, I must say adieu.
Okay, talk to you next week. Thank you, Howie.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Emil Guillermo joins us. He's the host of the PETA podcast, which you can find every Wednesday on iTunes and Stitcher and wherever fine podcasts are downloaded. Hello there, Mr. Guillermo.
Hello, Mr. Feldman. How are you?
People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals.
Yes.
Jack Dorsey, Twitter CEO, apologized for eating at Chick-fil-A because of their anti-gay policies. Good for him.
Who made him do it?
He posted on Twitter his receipt from Chick-fil-A. Mm. How about also promising not to eat at Chick-fil-A because of the LGBTQ chickens that are slaughtered there?
You know, there's got to be a few gay chickens out there. Yeah, I'm not joking. You know, they go through this whole chicken sexing process, as you know, in the factory farms. And there must be a one or two that slip through, you know. I mean, they're trying to be transgender in the chicken world, too, but, or, you know, fluid, open.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about the Jews.
Yes.
Now, I don't keep kosher, but I always assumed that kashrut was the gentlest way to kill an animal, that it was done swiftly. And a rabbi came in and knew where to put the blade so there'd be less pain. That is how I was brainwashed. But I'm a vegetarian.
That's the story they tell, right?
Yeah.
I mean the idea that if it's kosher, it's got to be good, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's the myth. It's the myth that's perpetrated, and there are some investigators at PETA that got word that this isn't necessarily so, and they began an investigation that goes back about the better part of a decade, and finally they came out with an undercover video in 2016 that really just changed how people saw the kosher laws in Israel as it pertained to kosher beef. And this month, because of that video that I happened to have voiced in 2016, I wasn't part of the real nuts and bolts undercover investigation, although I would have loved to have. I voiced the tracks, and that video is really a key centerpiece in the law changing this month in Israel. You cannot import beef, kosher beef, that was processed under what is known as the shackle-and-hoist slaughter method.
Now, this is done in South America, and it's imported.
It's done in Uruguay and Paraguay, and it's imported to Israel. And when it was exposed in 2016, it really created a large outcry from people in Israel, plus a worldwide outcry, but specifically in Israel, where they got the law changed. And it took, until June 1st, 2018, this month, to make sure that, the law was in place. But it's an historic legal precedent there in Israel. And yet, even though you can't bring this kind of meat into Israel, the South American slaughterhouses are still importing their or exporting their meat, their kosher meat, to the U.S.
Hmm.
So if you're at a Cubs game, I don't know if you're in Chicago and you get, you know, because they're really big on those beef kosher dogs.
Mm-hmm.
Chances are those the animals used for that dog were subject to shackle and hoist methods, which is not a pretty picture. And I urge people to go to the PETA website at PETA.org and check out the video. They'll hear my voice. They'll see the gruesome pictures, and they'll see why Israel banned the shackle and hoist method. It's just a terrible way for it's definitely not kosher. That was a shocking thing.
Yeah.
and yet here's the thing, you know, technically speaking, it could still be seen as kosher, and that's how the meat was being brought into Israel. And you know, the other aspects of the law, which says, well, you know, this is going to, you know, this is supposed to be the kindest and gentlest way in which we can, you know, take an animal's life.
Well, I'm looking at some of the, it's pretty rough to look at.
Yeah.
I would assume shackle and hoist was never anticipated in the Old Testament.
I don't know. Did Jesus get crucified? No, that wasn't shackle.
Yeah, I mean, but I'm looking at the actual slaughter, and it, he seems to be severing the head in the proper way to hit the carotid artery properly. So I understand what you're saying. In one sense, the slaughter is kosher. It's the foreplay that's not kosher.
Right. It's the steps leading up to it.
Yeah.
And even there were some instances in the undercover video where the person coming in before the head of the animal hit the ground, it was not performed as prescribed.
Here's the thing.
Thank goodness for undercover video, really.
Yeah.
That's really one of the highlights of the PETA investigations team, this undercover duo who go out around the world, and not just for kosher slaughter, but in terms of animal skins and down and all that. They're a very accomplished team. And this is, as they say, a feather in their cap. This
feather in their yarmulke.
In their yarmulke, yes. Yeah.
And by the way, feathers are not good. You taught me about down, so we don't put feathers in hats.
They're polyester feathers.
Yes. Hey, we're on at 6:30 on KPFK in LA during the dinner hour.
Yes.
This isn't television. This is radio.
Mm.
You know, with TV, it's gruesome. Nobody really, a lot of people, they want to taste the beef. I've said this a million times on my show. People want to taste the beef. They want to put it inside of them. But they don't want to see the beef. They don't want to see the beef when it was alive. They don't want to hear it screaming. They don't want to smell it in the slaughterhouse. They are up for only the taste and not the other senses. Describe, since this is radio, what shackle and hoist means, because it's radio. People don't have to see it. They don't have to smell it.
Well, they
let them hear it.
It's almost, it's, well, they, like I said, they can go to the video and they can hear the sounds. How about that?
They can hear
the
sounds. But I don't think they're going to. So describe what they do.
Okay, so basically they'll gang up on the cow, and they'll manhandle it, and it's not a gentle process. They it's sort of like a what is the term that they use?
They surround it.
It's like a
torture?
You know, not torture, but you know when they the words fail me now. But basically it's like a gang of men come up to the cow. And they grab it by the head, and they use a thing called a devil's claw, which is like a, it looks like a pitchfork, and they use that to torture the cow, and then when they get it down,
do they sedate the cow?
No. There's no sedation used. That's one of the problems with this method. They shackle the cow.
I thought they were supposed to stun the cow.
They're supposed to, but it's not. The cow is still. In fact, once they shackle the cow and they hoist it up, they can see the cow still writhing as it hangs. It's not pleasant, but I think if you can say you don't want to see it, you should see it, because when you do see it, it will convince you that this is not a gourmet treat. This is not something fit for a meal.
I'm looking at the pictures right now, and yeah, this is what Rabbi Shmuley Yanklowitz, president and dean at Valley Beit Midrash, says after seeing the video. It is hard to reconcile the humane slaughter that kashrut is meant to represent with this barbaric practice. And Dr. Temple Grandin is working with PETA.
Yeah, Temple Grandin is the expert witness that the investigators go to, because the investigators, and if you listen to my interview with Hannah Shine, who is the PETA investigator, she talks about being in the midst of all the, you know, the sinew and the blood and the water. I mean, it's just a, it really is quite an environment that you're placed in there. And she's trying to make sure she's positioned correctly to get everything in the hidden camera that she is concealing. And she's trying to capture it all. And it's the only thing that keeps her really from breaking down, because she's placed in this environment that is so it's a house of horrors, is to use her words. And so she's getting these images, but she makes no judgment, right? She makes no judgment as she's capturing these images. And then once they get the images back into the United States, then they show it to experts like Dr. Temple Grandin.
Right.
And
now they've phased out shackle and hoist in Israel, or no?
They banned the use of importing shackle and hoist processed beef. Mm-hmm. So kosher beef that's processed in this way, you can't bring in to Israel any longer. And all the companies in South America that are using these methods now have to change, and they have to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars if they're going to make up for the beef that they, you know, if they want to get that the same amount of business into Israel, they've got to pump in the money to change their methods, which means to have these rotating restraint pins, right, that are kinder and gentler. And they had the deadline of June 1st, 2018, and so it's most of the companies have followed suit. We'll see if there's a compliance issue. There shouldn't be, but at the same time, they're still able to send the shackle and hoist meat that they don't sell to Israel to places like the United States. And that's really where the action by your listeners is really needed.
Well, I'm at the investigation.peta.org/kosher-slaughterhouse-action page. And it's very simple. It says, take action now. They write the message for you. All you do is put your email in there and hit send. Who does it go to?
Well, the investigations team gets it. They'll send it to the South American slaughterhouses to show them directly what kind of response their practices are getting from consumers, mm-hmm, here in the United States, or actually worldwide, because the site is available for all to see. Right. And then the fact that this 2017 or the 2016 investigation caused an uproar in 2017 and got Israel to change its law, because there was something like 150,000 emails that came in. Mm-hmm. That says that, hey, maybe the same kind of pressure will get the Jewish community in the United States to take a stand, yeah, and to force pressure on the import of meat that's done by shackle and hoist to the U.S.
Volkswagen says it will no longer test its cars on animals. How are they testing their cars on animals?
Now, do you remember that story 5 months ago? It was in the New York Times.
There is a Volkswagen rabbit. They don't use real rabbits first, do they?
No. I had a Volkswagen diesel rabbit years ago.
Okay.
But no, here's the experiment. You get 10 macaque monkeys, you lock him inside a chamber.
Seriously.
And you force, seriously, you lock him inside a chamber. This is no joke. And you force him to inhale diesel fumes from an old pickup truck and a VW Beetle for 4 hours. That was the test.
And is this Volkswagen trying to get back to its roots?
I don't know, but this was a test that was revealed in it was reported in the New York Times, and this is a test that was done at Lovelace Respiratory Research Institute, which is a contract facility in Albuquerque, New Mexico. It broke in the Times, and because of this and because of other details about the rigging of tests and exhausts, you know, specifically related to exhausts, Volkswagen has come under pressure. This is the big scandal that has brought down that company. And, you know, I joke sometimes with folks I know that, hey, you know, Volkswagen should give, you know, they should start giving away cars at each dealership if they really want to make up for the kind of impact that this has had on their business. I mean, we're talking about maybe a giveaway may not be enough, though.
How many monkeys have they killed?
Well, it was a matter. The monkeys didn't die, apparently, but they had 10 macaque monkeys. They were forced into this chamber to inhale diesel fumes. And this is based on the reports. The report that was in the New York Times. PETA took action, fired off a letter to officials, Volkswagen officials in Germany, and then they continued, you know, one protest after another in Germany, and then just recently PETA got this letter that said that PETA Germany would no longer conduct any tests on animals unless required by law to do so. And so this is once again another example of what a little pressure. The investigation was not PETA's, but PETA applied the pressure and did the protests and forwarded about 160,000 emails from PETA supporters to the company. So PETA Germany sent that letter to PETA just about a week or so ago, and that was reported in the New York Times too. And they are the ones who broke the initial story about Lovelace Labs in New Mexico. So hopefully we won't see any more of these kind. I mean, just talking about this or describing this experiment. I mean, you thought I was joking, but
yeah,
this is no joke.
What does this do to people who are participating in this? It's got to be damaging, or they're already damaged and they enjoy
people?
It. Yeah.
Well, it's a sadistic business, right? I mean, when you're in experimentation, I mean, and this is a lab that's a contract lab. It's not like, I mean, you might be able to say, okay, well, these research facilities in our finest public institutions of higher education, well, at least there we have science, right?
Mm-hmm.
But that's probably even more diabolical, though, because that's really Dr. Frankenstein stuff, right?
Yeah.
And also the welfare mill of government grants in the millions supporting these public research institutions and these quote-unquote scientists, right? It's really the welfare mill for scientists doing these useless experiments because, I mean, what does it do? I mean, you know, these tests aren't lethal, you know, but what happens is the experimenters draw blood from the monkeys following exposure, and then an endoscope is inserted into the monkey's windpipe and bronchia through their noses to collect lung tissue from the animals.
And this is at the Lovelace Center.
Yeah, this is at the Lovelace Respiratory Research
Center. So at least they have orgasms.
Well, they had...
Sorry. I have to make some light of this because PETA reminds us of what is... inherently wrong with human beings. Because unless you're willing to take that step and think about other animals and switch to a plant-based diet, not murder, you really don't have the right to complain about the moral arc of the universe.
Well, it's
if you don't, you know, if it's not, if the universe isn't moral enough for you,
yeah,
you really got to start with switching to a plant-based diet. People don't want to hear that; they want to nibble around that.
People are selective, right?
Yeah,
I mean, it's situational.
Yeah, which brings us to Anthony Bourdain. Yeah. There were a couple of quotes. I loved Anthony Bourdain. Great writer. He was funny.
I did also. Look, I will say I was a fan, but I wrote something on the ALDEF blog, the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund blog, because, you know, he was kind of like a closeted Asian. The way he sucked down those noodles, mm-hmm. and the way he loved to go, you know, into the streets and get that street food. I mean, he was like a. I saw him as a practically an Asian American, and mm-hmm. in fact, one of the finest New York hand pulled noodle joints, Xian's Fine Foods. A lot of locations in Manhattan. It's one of my favorite places. I can get a cilantro salad and all these hand-pulled noodles, vegetarian even. Anthony Bourdain kind of put them on the map or helped get them started, and they donated a day's worth of profits to the suicide hotline. Bourdain was really... I was shocked, but I wrote something today that said maybe he was just killing himself slowly anyway, mm-hmm. you know, because he refused. He had no tolerance.
Boy, are you going to you are going to piss people? Go ahead. This is music to my ears. You're going to piss people off.
He had no tolerance for vegans or vegetarians. Said so often.
Called us a splinter group of Hezbollah.
Yeah, he was on record saying, look, he tried to be a nice guy about it. He said, look, I disagree with everything that the rocker hunter Ted Nugent, you know, ever said. But Bourdain found this sliver of common ground in the fact that they both liked barbecue.
Mm hmm.
And, okay, so, you know, they could share a good belch and a bowel movement, but after that, where was the common ground? I mean, really, after that, then how about to the bigger stuff? You know, he couldn't get to the bigger stuff. I mean, he saw the plate and the spoon, and he lived life on the edge of a fork, but is that it? I mean, I think he stopped there, and I think he could have seen that, he could have learned something from Kurt Cobain and from Chris Cornell that, you know, it doesn't all add up in the end unless you take that extra step. And I think with his stance on vegan, you know, his intolerance toward vegans and veganism and vegetarianism, I think... That was his shortcoming. I learn a lot of things from his shows and his writing. And in this marathon, I do a piece called "Suicidal Thoughts After Watching CNN's Anthony Bourdain Marathon" on the ALDEF blog at aaldef.org/blog, and I. You know, he did this thing on that super pricey New York City sushi master, Masayoshi Takayama. He did an episode where he goes back into the rural part of Japan. And there's this great line where Takayama is talking about Ichigo Ichii, which is this idea that a Zen phrase that loosely translated means to treasure every moment as a once-in-a-lifetime moment that will never happen again. You know, it's a stunning little idea that just stops you dead in your tracks. And this is what Bourdain discovers, right? And this is what, this is the probably one of the good things about his method, where you take the plate, you know, you take the meal, and it gets you into this cultural depth that, you know, you just don't get in other places, in books, and in speeches. And, you know, he was able to do that. That was his process, his method. And I appreciated that in his work, right? But it was, but he stopped short, right? He did not, he, you know, he had a blind spot, and the blind spot was with beef and the cruelty that, that goes on. I mean, although there's this one thing where he does, he goes into a, after devouring Waffle House pancakes, he goes out to hunt some wild turkeys, and he kind of says, hey, you're never going to see me shoot any turkeys. And so, you know, that he, maybe given time, he would have come around. But I don't know. I don't know. I just think that there's a part of me that when I heard that he had succumbed to suicide, actually, I first thought that maybe he had a heart attack, you know, the way he was eating. You just can't watch his shows and not feel like you are not eating and drinking enough. You know, like I watch his shows and I went, God, I got to pour myself a shot of bourbon. I need, you know, I see him drinking. I'm not drinking enough. I got to drink more, or I got to eat more. So I put some more kale in my air fryer and try to consume that. But, you know, he was
a brilliant writer. He was funny. He was on the right side of history, except for the vegan, the vegetarian stuff. And it's a, as you said, it's a real blind spot. 100 years from now, we're going to look back at meat eaters the same way we look back at Neanderthals. If we don't evolve past eating meat, we're going to be in some serious, we can't sustain the planet if we're all going to eat beef and chicken,
like even my college classmate, even though he's a dropout and I graduated, but you know, Bill Gates is trying to develop these alternatives to beef, you know, that are sustainable, that are good for you, and that will help the planet probably still more than people's
What about lab grown beef? Would you eat lab grown beef? I wouldn't. You know,
I don't know. I don't think I would. I am happy not eating any of it.
Yeah.
I mean, since I switched over to a plant-based diet, I don't miss it. I think there are times when I'll say, you know, I'll take the Bourdain approach, you know, the cultural respect for my host and hostess, I must you know, and because I'm Filipino, sometimes it's hard for me to abstain from Filipino cuisine. But but we're starting to see more and more ethnic foods that are vegan. I mean, there's a number of Filipino vegan food trucks and places that have opened up in the Bay Area now. And I think that if, you know, this week, June 14th, is not only Donald Trump's birthday.
Really?
Yeah, June 14th, on Flag Day. But it also is, coincidentally, the death day of my father.
Wow.
My father, who died of arteriosclerosis, primarily because of all the pork he ate and all the... you know, the gunk and plaque in his arteries. He died when he was just in his early 70s.
Right.
And, you know, I know that if I didn't go to a vegan diet, I'd be well on my way to being, you know, fulfilling that Asian American, Filipino American, idea of, you know, I'm going to have high blood pressure, diabetes, and die of arteriosclerosis, just like my father. But
switching over before you go, and thank you for this, and I hope you come back next week. The listeners should know that it's axiomatic. It's, you can't debate this. You should be eating a plant-based diet. That's a fact. If you don't believe that, you shouldn't be listening to my show, because we deal with science and certifiable truths. You should be switching to a plant-based diet. Now, some people can't do that. They don't have the discipline, the desire. They might have been convinced by their doctor that they need, what is it, B12? There's a vitamin.
B12, which you can get from other sources. Yeah. You don't have to have from meat, but it's in meat.
The first step is, if you listen to my show, you should be at least willing to admit that you're wrong. You're listening to my show, you're already doing something wrong. Admit that you're wrong if you're a beef eater. It's not, you know, it's not a crime, but just say, you know what? I should do better, and I should be on a plant-based diet. That's the first step. Admit that you're wrong. I admit that I'm wrong. You know, I eat sugar. I can't control myself. I wish I didn't. I'm wrong, but I'm wrong. You know, it's not right to eat sugar, but I do it. Admit that you're wrong for eating chicken, fish, and beef. You don't have to stop, but just admit that you're wrong. Spend a year saying, you know, if I switch to a plant-based diet, my carbon footprint would be zero. I could drive a 32-wheel diesel truck, and my carbon footprint would still be less because I've switched to a plant-based diet. The water that you waste eating beef and chicken, just admit that you're wrong for a year. Keep eating beef, but admit that you're wrong. And then after a year, Meatless Mondays. Have one day without meat. Try it.
Yeah. Or, you know, they go Meatless Fridays, but then they eat the fish, you know, the Catholics.
Yeah.
But maybe you can just make it totally meatless, including no fish. Because a lot of people say, what, no fish? Well, okay, if you want the mercury. If you insist on having the mercury, I guess you can eat fish.
Beans. I know people go, beans are delicious. Beans are a gift from whatever God you believe in. Beans are a gift. Beans and rice pretty much have everything you need to survive. It's a miracle. Why make it more complicated? You could live on beans and rice.
I like to avoid the rice. I just go with the beans. And I have this diet that I use called the G-Bombs diet. And it's popularized by one of those late night doctors that come on PBS. He's a great guy. Dr. Furman. He's a good guy. Okay. There are another, Dr. Barnard is a good guy. He's
Dr. Furman, that's, he uses the N-word a lot, right?
No, not that Furman. No. He drinks a lot of OJ, that guy.
Okay.
Dr. Furman believes in the G-bomb diet. Greens, beans, onions, mushrooms, berries, and seeds. That's what you concentrate on. And if you just go on that for a couple of days,
yeah,
you know, you can transition out of meat eating, have all the protein you need, have all the nutrients you need. G-bombs.
Yeah. And again, I sympathize with people who want to quit but can't. Mm-hmm. I'm tempted by sugar all the time. I try to stay off sugar.
Really?
And I know sugar leads to cancer and heart disease. That's my vice.
The donuts, a weakness? You can't walk by a Dunkin' Donuts or something, or
bread pudding.
Bread pudding. Yeah, I know what you mean. Look, I have some
which has
some
eggs in it and nothing. I'm not perfect. I'm not a vegan yet.
Look, perfection is hard. Perfection is hard. I mean, it's like I'm somewhat of a religious man, and you know, we try not to sin, but thank goodness there's forgiveness. I mean, I think we aim for perfection. We try our best. And when we fail, we we get back up and we continue the journey. But it is a journey.
Yeah.
But I will say, since I think within the last 6 months, I've lost something like 30 pounds when I just was more focused on trying to do my diet plus intermittent fasting, which is another kind of a fad these days. But it makes sense. And
Do you go a day without food? What is the intermittent fasting?
Intermittent fasting is I try to eat within a 5 to 6 hour window. And then that means I'm fasting for about 18, 19 hours a day. Hmm. And most of the time I'm sleeping, right? I'm sleeping that 19 hours. But then I'm drinking a lot of coffee and apple cider vinegar and that kind of stuff. But it's essentially you skip breakfast and you eat within this, like I said, 5 or 6 hour window. And, you know, every now and then I'll try to stretch it to 24 hours. But basically, you end up eating maybe one meal a day.
Right. They've done studies that mice who are not fed live longer than mice who are fed.
Well, maybe that's true. I know that when you get older, and we've known each other a long time, David, but I know that one doesn't need as much food as one ages as you think. And so I find that I feel healthier, and I know that a lot of it is, I mean, there's no real secret, you know. It's a lot of it is willpower. A lot of it is also knowing that, you know, you feel better. You feel better when you are eating in control rather than eating out of control. And that was, you know, to get back to Bourdain, that's one of the things that I always thought, you know, he was always eating. Yeah, I mean, here's the guy, you know, he ate everything, he drank anything, he lived life to the fullest, and somehow, you know, it isn't quite the answer to the questions that we pose in our lives. It's not the answer to happiness.
Yeah.
And that's sort of the thing that you realize. So what are the answers? And it usually comes after the meal. It usually comes or doesn't include the meal. You know, the answers are out there, but that's why we're searching.
Right. Emil Guillermo is the host of the PETA podcast, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. It drops every Wednesday. Thank you, sir. I'll talk to you next week.
Yeah, thanks, David.
Stay on the line for 1 second. Let's go to our man in London. Jacob Sager Weinstein is standing by. I think he's won a couple of awards writing for television. He's graduated to novels. He's the author of a children's thriller called Hyacinth, The Secrets Beneath. That's part of a trilogy. Book two is out. It's called Hyacinth and the Stone Thief, available in bookstores near you. Is it a trilogy? Is there going to be a number three?
There will be a three, but I would say I describe it as more of a fantasy adventure than a thriller. She does stumble onto a conspiracy, but it is a conspiracy involving mud monsters in royal male uniforms rather than like spies and the things that traditionally a thriller would be about.
You're also the author of How Not to Kill Your Baby, which you can get on Amazon.
Mm, that's right.
Yeah. Brexit. We keep hearing about it. It's happening. I always thought cooler heads were going to prevail, but Britain is pulling out of the EU. Did the Russians cause this? Back here in the States, we think the Russians played a role in all this.
Нет, товарищ. That is, I can't prove that they did, and I want to emphasize that what I'm about to say is very. There's a lot of smoke, and I suspect there will be fire. I don't know if this is just in the newspapers here today, that one of the major financial backers here in the UK of the Brexit movement met several times with a Russian official under suspicious circumstances. Mm-hmm. And it's the kind of thing where
Aaron Banks,
maybe he just
Aaron
like,
Banks.
So I don't want to intimidate your listeners by the sheer amount of research I've done today, but I actually spent 5 minutes walking through my grocery store, glancing at the headlines on my way to buy fruit. So I'm gonna dazzle you with some knowledge.
Just make stuff up. Just yes and yes and.
I don't have to. I'm well informed by the headlines. Okay, I tell you the other fascinating news that I think is really interesting from a policy position, which is Pippa dazzles in new summer swimming suit.
Now Pippa would be the sister of the Duchess of Cambridge.
Yes, this is Pippa Middleton, who you may not care about the if you don't care about the royals, as is my feeling, then she is your not care about in law.
Does she get invited to Buckingham Palace?
Oh, I'm sure she must. I mean, we invite my sister-in-law to our flat all the time. And, you know, the royals are just like us.
Uh-huh. Now, with the Duchess of Sussex, I'm talking about Meghan Markle.
Yes, of course. She's just Meghan to me. When she comes over, we're very casual. Mm-hmm.
Have you thought of writing a screenplay about the possibilities of who could end up being queen or king of Great Britain?
You know, now that you mention it, you could make a great movie where, like, everybody gets, say, electrocuted by in the process of being photographed, and an American bumpkin named Ralph. Oh, they've done it, damn it. Ah.
That was John Goodman.
Yes, uh-huh. Exactly.
What about a gay king having a gay wedding?
You know, I would not be... I will say this. I will make this bold prediction. We will certainly have a gay prime minister before we have a gay president. We may even have a gay king or queen before America has a gay president. And I'm not happy about that as an American, but as a British person, I intend to lure that over.
Now,
I should mention I'm a joint citizen, so I can sort of claim allegiance to whichever country gives me the conversational advantage in that moment.
Is Great Britain, the stereotype is that Great Britain is more understanding. The stereotype is it's a gay country. Is it a gay country? In America, we like to say... Now, is that because Americans who are gay put on a British affect? Or is it a gay country?
So this is very impressive. I've been on your podcast many times, and I believe the last 30 seconds hold the record for the most ways I can get in deep trouble in a single conversation. This is, I commend you, Mr. Feldman. You have outdone
everybody.
There's
so many landmines now. Everybody's so afraid. I was on Facebook over the weekend saying, let's not romanticize Anthony Bourdain's suicide. You know, whatever happened to suicide is not the option. You know, it's kind of bad to commit suicide. We're a little too understanding of it. Boy, did...
Maybe you've been seeing different Facebook posts than I have. I haven't seen anybody saying that, like, applauding Bourdain for his suicide. I've seen a lot of people applauding Bourdain for his life and telling people who may be suffering depression that they can reach out and get help. Do you see that as a sign of weakness? Because that is not at all how I see
think
that.
There's been a tendency to romanticize him and be very forgiving of his pain, as opposed to saying there's a little personal responsibility here. You can't commit suicide. And it just seems to be presented as an option now, which might contribute to the contagion.
Okay, so I think, although you and I disagree on many things, I think something you and I have in common is we both believe in science. That if somebody has spent their life studying something and applying the scientific method to it, I'm inclined to assume they know more about it than I do. And I'm not a psychiatrist or psychologist, but my understanding is that the contemporary medical thinking is that suicide and depression are specific mental conditions. They're not just being weak. They're not just doing the wrong thing. It's a specific mental condition. There are specific therapies that can treat it depending on the specific source of it. And again, I'm not a psychiatrist, but I think just telling people you're a bad person if you do this has not been shown to be a clinically effective.
I'm not saying you're a bad person for committing suicide. I'm saying you can't do it. It's unacceptable.
Yeah, but again, I don't think that's what's, I don't think that stops.
Right, but I
think
but,
that's.
But I think that there's a little, under the guise of compassion and this heart pouring that goes out for Anthony Bourdain, there's some accountability that has to be laid out in front of him. You can't commit suicide. It's just it's just not acceptable. And people need to keep saying that. There's a little too much understanding of it. I worry about that. That's all.
When I hear people really desperate or really passionate about taking an option off the table, about it's when it's really important for people, when it's really important for an evangelical to say we can't have gay marriage, people, it's not an option, people should not have gay sex, because if we let that, then everybody would. I hear an echo of that in what you're saying, and I'm wondering, and again, tell me, you don't have to answer this, but is this something you've struggled with, that you sometimes felt?
No, I've struggled with like other people not committing suicide. I've been trying to No, I think there are some basic rules of the road. You can't molest kids. If you have an urge to molest your child or somebody else's child, and I know it can't be cured. They've said that about child molestation. You can't cure a pedophile. You have to suppress that urge. Those are the rules of the road. If you're suicidal, if there's so much pain in your brain, you can't commit suicide. You just can't.
So I guess I feel like I agree with every stone in your quarry, but I'm not sure I'm quite willing to move into the castle you're building yet. And what I mean is that I absolutely agree with you. Certainly suicide should not be an option. And I saw your Facebook post and you talked about the responsibilities Anthony Bourdain had to his family. And I get where you're coming from. But I guess my question is, if your goal is to stop suicide, does saying what you're saying help? Does applying guilt to somebody, even if it's a theoretical... Yes. Well, here's... You know, again, I'm not an expert. I will tell you my own very limited experience is when I was a teenager, I never tried to commit suicide. I never got to the point of having a plan, but there were times where I contemplated it. And in my case, I don't think there was anything specific. I was a very lucky, privileged kid. I think it's just sort of the usual emotional turmoil of adolescence. But, and maybe because I had sort of a mild case of whatever that is, I was able to think about the effect that it would have on my family, and I was able to consider that. And that was probably one of the things that in my case did stop me from doing it. But I will also tell you that I know that people that I had a mild case of it. When I've read firsthand accounts of people who have been much closer than I ever was, there's not that ability to think things through in the way you're suggesting people should. It's like, you know, the analogy people always use is that if you have a broken leg, you can't just tell somebody, just get better, stop being broken. But the issue is that you're not thinking with your leg. The broken part of you is not the part that's analyzing how to get better. And when you have a mental issue, you're trying to solve the problem with the limb that is suffering.
I'm not vilifying anybody who commits suicide.
Right.
But I don't think it should be presented as an understanding option to people. I think part of the contagion that takes place, especially among teenagers in high schools, because once one kid kills himself, it's like the hula hoop. The idea of killing yourself in France, there's something romantic about that. The idea of killing yourself is an act of anger. And I don't understand suicide. I understand the pain, the mental pain that could cause somebody to see no options. And it's tragic and sad. When we talk of suicide as an option, it presents itself to people who are in a lot of pain. I just think you have to have, it's like child molestation. You have to say, you can't do it, period. That I think you have to say that, don't you? Doesn't the Bible say no suicide?
Well, yeah, but the Bible also says no shrimp.
No shrimp?
So, you know, that, shellfish, surely you know the two things that the Bible describes as an abomination in the eyes of the Lord are homosexuality and shellfish. So I've always wanted to sort of like stand outside some right-winger's house and protest the fact that he's teaching children about shrimp and lobsters and saying that we should not expose our children to this decadent shellfish lifestyle.
But that's Leviticus, but, right? I mean, but nothing in the New Testament, nothing in the Talmud, right, about homosexuality. Just agree with me. Nobody reads this stuff. Trust me.
Yes, well, I think Mr. Feldman and Mr. Sager Weinstein are in agreement on what Jesus says about homosexuality. Nope. Paul says there's some brief things about men lying with men, but Jesus himself never said anything. And in any case, you're baiting
no,
me.
No, I'm not.
This.
Did All Paul right, well, really the, say that about the, men lying with men?
I think so. And again, this is, unfortunately, there was nothing about Paul's prescriptions on homosexuality on the headlines of the newspapers I walked by this morning. So I haven't even done my 30 seconds of research. But if I remember my Episcopal school education of 30 years ago, I believe there is one or two references to men should not lie with men, but that's about as much as the New Testament says. And it's not from Jesus himself. It is from one of his disciples.
Well, I guess what I'm trying to say is if you're listening, and you're in a lot of pain, and if you're listening, you probably are in a lot of pain. Suicide's not an option. I need all the listeners. I can't lose any listeners.
So I would say if you're listening, I would certainly agree that suicide is not an option, but I would say that the step beyond it is not just to say don't do it, it's to reach out and get help. And if you have friends, if there's suicide hotline numbers, there's a step beyond don't do it, and that is get help.
Okay. All right. So back to Brexit.
Yes.
This is going to...
Yes, speaking of self-harm.
Are you for Brexit or against it?
I am strongly for Brexit because I think it's time we got rid of all those foreigners like me who are coming to this country and dragging it down. No, I am against Brexit. I am baffled by it. You said earlier in the conversation that you're amazed that it seems like it's going to happen, that you thought cooler heads would prevail. There is still the chance that it will. There's a bill that Parliament is currently debating, and as I understand it, it is not pro or against Brexit. It assumes that Brexit will happen, and it is an effort to sort of harmonize, to figure out how you fill the hole in British laws when EU laws no longer apply. So the House of Commons sent it to the House of Lords, who added a bunch of amendments to it, which are just, crazy things saying Parliament should actually get a vote in the final say. And then they sent it back. It's also things about having to do with sort of immigrants' rights and other things. Commons over the next 2 days is going to be voting on how to proceed with this newly amended bill. The Tories are pretty upset that the Lords have amended it as much as they have. Basically, they would say that the House of Lords does not have, that the House of Lords isn't supposed to stop the country from shooting itself in the foot. They should just like help us.
What happened? Yeah, hello, are you alive?
I am alive. Apparently, I just think for a minute I exited this interview, but I seem to be back.
Okay, good.
I was saying, so Theresa May is accusing the House of Lords.
Theresa May is the Prime Minister.
Yes, she is the Prime Minister. She's the perfect person to lead Brexit because she was opposed to it up to the moment it happened. And then suddenly she was for it. And even though it's going to ruin the country, she's promised to make a success of it. So I think she is the ideal leader for these times.
Okay. Not to sound Trumpian, maybe all this stuff is just gobbledygook. The EU, maybe you don't need the European Parliament. And maybe we're just
convinced that it's a populist move to pull out, and it's silly and stupid and dangerous. We don't understand any of this stuff, including the people in charge.
I feel like I'm listening to the next Prime Minister of Great Britain.
I don't know. We accept things because we're told that it's the right way to think. But we don't really understand how this stuff works.
I'm really not joking. I say that was more or less the pro-Brexit campaign platform. Was there's an actual quote, which was, "I think the British people are sick of hearing from experts."
Well,
and it's this idea that has infected the United States as well, that my opinion is as good as your lifetime of research into the facts.
Okay. Crime in Great Britain.
Yes.
From what I understand, you guys don't have guns. A couple of your cops do. About 6,000 cops have guns in all of Great Britain. You had a crime rate that was so low, you started firing cops, and now they're gangs and stabbings and even shootings. And I read somewhere that London's murder rate is actually higher this year than New York's.
It has been higher in certain months, which is shocking to me. You know, I think you said it when you said that we started getting rid of cops, that there has been, under the Tories, there has been this real austerity push over the past couple of years. And actually, it sort of ties into the argument you were making before, that, look, who knows if having police officers in the street actually prevents crime? Let's find out. Let's get rid of a lot of them and see what happens. And this is the consequence. And I still feel because there's strict gun control law here, I still feel vastly safer walking down the streets of London than I do many places in the world. But it is shocking to me, and it's a real condemnation of austerity that London has, even if only temporarily, caught up to New York.
Do you feel bullied on the street?
No, I've never had a problem. I feel totally safe walking down the street. And maybe I'm naive, but I just haven't had a problem.
There was a BBC presenter who was mugged. People are being mugged all the time now. It seems to me that the headlines in Great Britain are about the crime rate, that it's gone up, and that there are these stabbings. I've advocated for firing more and more police officers and hiring more teachers in America because the crime rate has gone down.
I want to propose a compromise here, which is, what if you fire the police officers and you also fire teachers?
Now you're talking.
This is the Tory policy. Yes, yes. This is so. Yeah, I mean, there has been, you know, Tony Blair's slogan many years ago was "tough on crime, tough on the causes of crime." And I think the Tories have taken the spirit of that on and sort of soft on crime, soft on the causes of crime, that they're cutting back. You know, there's been cuts in school libraries. There's been cuts all around. So I think it's not just a short term problem. I do think we'll be seeing the consequences of this for years to come.
Well, it's an interesting experiment to see what happens when you get rid of cops. You're saying crime goes up. I happen to think that the austerity in Great Britain is causing lots of problems among the people, like drug use is up.
That was not mentioned in the headline about Pippa's new bathing suit,
In Great Britain, cocaine is an epidemic. Did you know that?
I did
not
know that.
The highest proportion of cocaine users in Europe is in Britain. Now, you have kids. 4% of children in Great Britain have taken cocaine. Taken it.
Yeah, that's shocking to me. What age are the children in that?
18 to 34. At my age, I call them kids.
No, and I think that's a symptom. I do think that there is, sort of a symptom of the overall, I guess, the overall lack of trust in society and economic anxiety. Yeah.
How do you treat yourself in London? I wish I were there right now.
Well, that's why I treat myself in London. You're not here. It's a Feldo Frizo. No, I would love to have you here. The way I treat myself, honestly, is just walking through the city. I find this just such an amazing city to walk through. It's so walkable that if I get the chance, I would walk from my house in northwest London into the center of the town, which would be like an hour and a half, 2 hours. You walk over Primrose Hill and have a gorgeous view of the city. You walk into the city. It's a great walk.
And what are you going to eat? I know you're a foodie.
Ah, so this is a difficult question, because my two favorite gelato places in London are both sort of on the walk I would take into the center of town. So I would either eat gelato or gelato. And if you could follow up with me next time, I will, but it's actually literally when I go into these places, they now know me, they recognize me, they smile at me. So basically after 15 years living in London, I finally have a local.
Has it been 15 years?
It's been 15 years. We moved here for a 2-year stay in 2002, and we are still here.
Wow. Well, Jacob Sager Weinstein is the author of Hyacinth, The Secrets Beneath. His new book is Hyacinth and the Stone Thief. It's a children's, I call it like a thriller, but how did you want to describe it?
Yes, you call it that because you have not read it, but that's...
Well, I'm not a child.
Well, fair enough. I describe it as a fast-paced fantasy set in London.
And you're also the author of How Not to Kill Your Baby. You've been coming to us today from London, England, so you claim. Thank you.
Comrade, I don't know what you mean.
Stay on the line for 1 second.
All right.
If you're enjoying today's show, do me a favor and subscribe to it on iTunes, Stitcher. We have a YouTube channel. It's just audio, but some people like to listen to this show on YouTube, so subscribe to our YouTube channel and do me a favor and give us a good review on iTunes. You'd be amazed how much that helps. Giving us a good review on iTunes moves us up. That's the way their algorithm works. So when you give us a good review on iTunes, you're really helping out. Go to, where are you, Joe DeVito? Queens? Brooklyn?
Long Island. Nassau County.
Nassau County. Joe DeVito, you travel a lot, right?
I do. It's the nature of the game.
Okay. When the room is comped and you give a credit card for incidentals.
Yeah.
And you're charged not just for your room, but for somebody else's room. And it shows up on your credit card.
Yeah, that's not good.
How long does it take for that charge to get reversed? What is a reasonable expectation?
Are you dealing with the hotel or with your credit card company, too?
The hotel right now.
Yeah, they do that weird thing where they put a hold on your... Sometimes they charge your card just in case. But why would they make you pay for someone else's room?
I was staying at the Freepoint Hotel.
Mm-hmm. That name should have thrown you off, that they were going to screw you. Never. Be careful. Anytime you stay at a hotel where the name mentions how much money you're going to save, that's not good.
Yeah.
The Econo Lodge, not good.
This was in Cambridge, Massachusetts.
Okay.
The room was being paid for by somebody else, and I ordered room service. So I said, as I'm checking out, let me give you my credit card for the incidentals, but make sure my room doesn't get charged. And I specifically said three times to the woman behind the counter, I said, make sure that this credit card that I'm giving you is only for the incidentals, not for the room. The room has been paid for by somebody else. And she said, okay. And I said, I really don't want to interrupt Joe DeVito's segment on my show to complain about you. Three times I said, sure enough, not only did I get charged for my room, but I got charged for my friend's room. I got billed for both rooms. So now there's a $900 charge on my credit card. And by the way, how dare they charge $450 for a room at the Freepoint Hotel in Cambridge, Massachusetts? That's like a $100 room.
Yeah. Well, I think you might want to take another look at that, because I think $800 of that was for your shrimp cocktail. You had to get the extra cocktail sauce, didn't you? If they're charging you for someone else's room, too, that's a rather expansive definition of incidental.
Yeah. Thank you.
I think incidental at that point could include a purchase anywhere at any time. It's sort of a rather global definition. Yeah, I think the problem is I never order room service, because I feel like you're then activating them to use your credit card, and it never ends well.
You know, I didn't order room service. You know what I did? I got some chips and a bottled water. I'm trying to sound fancier than I really am. I went downstairs in the middle of the night and got some chips.
You got it from, like, the little pantry?
Yeah.
Oh, that's not good.
And then I have to call them that night, because I, you know, go online to check my credit card, and I see the $970 charge. Mm. And now it's like 3 hours on the phone with these people to get the goddamn charge reversed.
Yeah, then you end up having to call the home office, and there's never anyone who can actually help you.
No. It's so frustrating. And then, you know, I had to fly to Florida dealing with United Airlines, and the lines at the kiosk, they've automated the ticket processing now at United Airlines, and there was like a line 12 deep. And I'm thinking, tell me again how corporations are more efficient than our government. As you know, I've never been treated this way by the post office. And at least with the post office, you can complain to your congressman. You can complain to somebody. Yeah. There's nobody to complain to. And if you raise your voice at the airport, you get arrested. It's such a scam. Oh, you're a threat now. We're going to call Homeland Security because you want dignity. I watched them threaten somebody.
Yeah, they cower you.
$950 some odd because some incompetent over at the Freepoint Hotel in Cambridge, Massachusetts doesn't know how to work the swiper for credit cards.
How did you leave off?
I've been on the phone. I've been on the phone for 3 hours all week trying to get this charge reversed.
I would call the credit card company and tell them just to dispute the charge.
I am doing that, but it's time consuming. And the way these corporations work is they just expect you to throw up your hands and surrender and give up.
They plan on that. Their assumption is you are a grain of sand and I am a monolith, so I can wait this out. So I've hired completely incompetent people to interact with you. I was on on the phone with customer service with UPS about a week ago, because I believe when someone says we've left the package outside your door, that means if I open my door, I should see a package. They think as long as they got the zip code correct,
mm-hmm.
that counts as outside my door. So My package made it across the country. It made it to Long Island. It made it to the distribution. It made it, and just the last 12 feet to my door, they just couldn't make that last part of the trip.
Yeah.
So they left my package in the laundry room of my apartment complex.
Right. You know what my feeling is? I'm off the grid.
Yeah.
It's like, F it. I am not going to travel. I'm not going to buy anything. I, like, F this whole economy. Yeah. F it. I mean it. It's not worth the aggravation. Anything you purchase causes aggravation.
Oh, yeah.
And it's not satisfying. And none of it is satisfying. These toys that you think you want, they don't fill the void. They just create more frustration. When's the last time you bought something that satisfied an itch, that scratched
an itch
for you?
Cortisone cream? That actually was helpful with my itch. I think, I'll tell anybody, go reread the Unabomber's Manifesto and you think, all right, this guy was on to something.
Theodore Kaczynski.
Yeah, I've seen quotes from Ted Kaczynski where when I saw it was attributed to him, I thought, all right, you got me. Because what he said made so much sense, I thought they were goofing around.
What did he say?
He was, I guess you'd call him a Luddite, but he was saying how technology was making us all lazy and stupid. And he was right. He was correct.
The happiest I am is when I'm flat on my back reading a book. Maybe watching a movie and eating. The stuff that they keep trying to get me to buy doesn't work and just sucks up my time.
Yeah. No, I'd agree with you. I felt, well, you know, I used to work in advertising and marketing, and when I see what's on TV commercials, I don't drink soda, I don't drink beer, I don't give a shit about cars, and I don't really go see blockbuster movies. So almost all of the commercials on TV, it's people arguing about stuff I don't care about. And I don't say those are my interests or what I'm not interested in, to make it sound like, I don't want to sound like one of those people who says, I don't even own a TV, because they're kind of annoying. But I just don't care about those things. So I look at advertising, and to me, it just baffles me that people have these strong opinions as to McDonald's versus Burger King or Coke versus Pepsi. It's, who gives a shit? That's why I'm so much more comfortable now that I watch my old man shows, and it's all long commercials in between about term life insurance and so-and-so died. And I enjoy watching those commercials because the acting is so bad. They're almost they're surreal. Penn Life Insurance? Yeah. I don't know what the fuck that company does, but I do know that the people in the commercial need to take a workshop. That I can relate to.
Okay. Well, let's talk about important issues. In Pasco County, Florida, police arrested Cody Blake Hessen after he drove his car into a ditch. And as he was getting out of the ditch, they noticed that a capuchin monkey was clinging to his pink polo shirt.
I did.
Did you see that story?
I have to say, as a Florida news story, I was a little disappointed. I know it had a car crash. I know it had weird wildlife attached to a person. But I didn't see a strange drug angle.
Maybe the monkey was up.
I think it would have been a better story if when they got him out of the car, the monkey actually was a dead monkey that had been stuffed with drugs.
There's nothing funny about a dead monkey. We love monkeys.
I don't want to sound anti-monkey. I don't even know if I am anti. I think I am anti-monkey, tell you the truth. When someone tells me they have a pet monkey, I know that they're fucked up. I know that there's something, they're worse than the ferret people, for God's sake.
Are you allowed to have a pet monkey?
He did not have the requisite wildlife permit, according to Florida. Because, you know, Florida, they're real sticklers down there.
Well, and the monkey wasn't from Florida. I think he got it from a breeder.
An illegal. Build that wall. See, you can't build that wall because the monkeys climb right over it. They're really good like that.
So they're monkey breeders now.
Yeah, I'd like to see that business card. Did you get him? There's probably a person who read this and thought, those damn monkey mills.
Well, yeah.
That was all right. You know, the stuff with drugs, that's an urban legend that pops up every now and then that someone on a flight, there was a couple with a baby, but it turns out it was a dead baby that had been stuffed with drugs. Well, it's an urban legend, but that's one that pops up pretty often. And every time I hear that, I think, look, as long as there's no crying during the flight, I'm good. I'll even say to them, can I get a hit off your baby? Don't Bogart that baby.
We love monkeys and we love babies.
But we ain't saying which has got the number one spot, are we? Is it from one of those baby breeders? Those are the worst, especially in Florida. I want to see your paperwork. Who authorized you to crank a couple out?
Well, there's a new world record in Ireland. 2,500 women set the record for world's largest skinny dip on Saturday. According to Guinness World Book of Records, they broke the record set 3 years ago in Australia by 786 women. 3 years ago.
Yeah, this was pretty cool. Mm. It was to raise money. I believe they were almost all cancer survivors, and I thought that was cool. But I'd have to say, Irish skinny dipping, I think that's the first time that there was an eclipse that's originated on the earth just out of Irish paleness.
Yeah, I know. You have to wear those special glasses or you go blind.
The sun said, you know what? I can't look directly at this. All these pale Irish bodies.
Yeah. I guess it wouldn't happen in America. One word, skinny. I think you can't skinny dip.
Well, skinny dipping, that's not, whenever you see the people who do that, that's not the first word that comes to mind, that they're lean and lithe and have those dancer's builds. It's kind of like any sort of people who are super into nudity. I think sometimes they're just trying to get a rise out of you with the grossness of their body.
Yeah, well, how does that, I mean, God bless them. If it raises money for cancer, then, you know, more power to you. But how does getting naked, like, how does that raise money? What is that?
To me, that's always a very strange form of protest.
Yeah.
That, well, again, I think it's great that they're raising money for that cause. But if you're trying to fight cancer, we don't need a bunch of Irish people out in the sun. I mean, I'm starting to think, did they break even on cancer? Did they fought it, but they went and caused it at the same time? But the getting naked is a form of self-expression or as a protest. It in a lot of cases, it seems desperate to me that even, you know, you see some of these events where a woman will jump up behind someone and rip her clothes off and say, aha, I'm a feminist, here's my tits. And when women do that, I have to ask them, you know, the guys you're protesting are kind of cool with seeing tits.
So this was, it's called a strip and dip.
Okay.
Strip and dip.
I thought that was a new Nabisco product.
Sounds
doesn't it like a fruit roll up that you stick into some kind of weird cheese, some sort of disgusting snack?
Strip and dip. Southwest Airlines is disturbed by a report. Pack a lunch, folks. This is going to be a long one. Southwest Airlines is disturbed by a report that a passenger masturbated throughout the flight. A female passenger flying from Las Vegas to Philadelphia on board a Southwest Airlines flight says a male passenger sitting next to her watched porn on his iPad while masturbating into a tissue. She was going from Las Vegas to Philadelphia. If she's, you know, disturbed by men jerking off, what's she doing going to Philadelphia? So what did you hear about this story? Was it you?
It was not me.
Okay.
I prefer to jerk off in the airport when there's a layover. I don't like to do it on the plane. I guess I get a little sick to my stomach. If that had been me, I would have... When you're on the plane, how do you not finish into the air sickness bag? You just hand it to the flight attendant and everybody's good. This story... All right. No one should have to sit next to someone who's masturbating. It's just, I don't, do I really need to state that? Look, everybody, look, I just want to make sure the record's clear on that. But instead of calling someone over or even just smacking the guy's hand away, the way she complained was she started sending a bunch of tweets to the airline. Yeah. And she got mad that they didn't respond. But the idea that you're sitting next to someone who's doing something you don't like, so you you send a tweet which goes out. It has to be read by someone at Southwest. It has to be returned. It's insane. You know, lady, say to the guy, knock it off, or say, flight attendant, get over here, or ask, if you're afraid, ask a dude on the plane. Ask a random guy. I'm sure a random guy would be willing to say, if you're afraid of this guy, if you want him to stop, I bet you 9 out of 10 men would say, hey, you, buddy, knock it off.
Yeah. I'm not a woman, and it's the Louis C.K. conversation. Apparently, when a woman sees a man jerking off, it's menacing.
Well, it's not a good thing.
Yeah, I mean it's sexual assault. You and I can't imagine that, but women are threatened by it.
I can imagine it. I don't think I'd like to see it.
Yeah,
David, I don't even like when people talk next to me. Let alone start rubbing one out.
I would prefer them rubbing one out than asking me where I'm flying to.
Oh, God. And, oh, so you're a comedian. And I've often said to people, can you just sit there and masturbate quietly instead of this metaphorical masturbation? That's the problem. Because let me tell you, with actual masturbation, no one could possibly last as long as some of the conversations I've had to sit through. It's almost as if they've taken some sort of pain in the ass verbal Viagra where they can not shut the fuck up all night. Ask your doctor about that.
It was kind of menacing. She said after, this is what the article said, she said that after leaving the plane, the guy, quote, looked at me, told me he hoped I enjoyed the show. Mm-hmm. Hope you enjoyed the show. So he knew what he was doing. No merch table, though. Surprisingly.
Yeah. What made it even more menacing was that he'd actually drawn a very small mustache on his penis. That's how you know it's the villain.
She told TMZ that when she did finally report the man to the flight crew at Southwest, a supervisor said, oh, that's horrible. Here's a dinner voucher.
Yeah, because I'm sure you've worked up a powerful appetite.
I'm good. Yeah. I filled up on the nuts. Thanks.
Yeah. I mean, I don't look. I think it's a very strange story, and I think she, again, no one should have to deal with that, but I don't think a lot of people would put up with that. They would immediately do something. But, you know, the airline is not without some fault here. I mean, it's Southwest, you know, and that recent ad campaign, you are now free to move about your penis. I think that is sent a wrong message.
Please obey the no stroking sign. Yeah.
Please fasten your cock rings. We're about to
Well, yeah, the belt was around his neck. I don't know about him, but you fly Southwest, right?
I don't think I ever have.
You've never flown Southwest?
No, I've never gone anywhere where maybe I have, because I know a lot of times I buy a ticket and you think you're on Delta. And then you get to the airport and they went and whored you out to some regional, you know, Bob's airline. But I don't think I've ever flown Southwest. Do they give you good snacks, or are they like a little bit more? Is Southwest the one where you don't have the seats assigned?
Southwest, well, they used to do that. Now they don't have any seats.
Yeah.
That's what.
Oh, you know what? Was she in the no stroking section?
Yeah.
Is that what you said earlier?
Yeah. Yeah. Southwest is the great airline for autoerotic asphyxiation. I should mention that because the air is so stale. You don't need to wrap a belt around your neck to block the flow of oxygen to your brain. It does save on belts if you're...
Do you just do the whole flight with the oxygen mask on? They just drop it down to you?
Have you ever been tempted to masturbate on a plane?
No, I think... I don't know. I usually fall asleep as soon as I get on the plane. For all I know, I could have been in the middle of some sort of bukkake gangbang. All I know is I wake up dry and I'm good to go.
I masturbated once on a plane.
Yeah?
Years ago.
But that was on the tarmac.
Well, they said that they wanted somebody to foam down the runway.
They said, we're just a tiny bit overweight for this flight. If someone could just remove, say, a tablespoon of weight.
No, I did. I jerked off once on an airplane. This was like 20 years ago. But in my defense, the in-flight movie was about Schmidt, where Kathy Bates gets out of the hot tub naked.
Oh, so you were masturbating to win a bet with someone.
That was very brave of her. Did you ever see About Schmidt?
No, that's Nicholson, right?
Yeah, Kathy Bates gets out of a hot tub naked. And good for her.
That was good for her. Yeah. And right after that, Jack Nicholson ran to fuck a woman half his age.
Well, in health news, Kat Von D says she won't vaccinate her baby. Did you read about this? Kat Von?
No, I didn't. But I would assume that anything that passes through her vagina has been exposed to so many toxins.
Kat Von D says she won't vaccinate her baby because she believes, and write this down, mm-hmm. she says immunization shots are not safe.
Yeah, I don't take medical advice from people with face tattoos. That advice has never done me wrong.
Yeah. Isn't she a tattoo artist?
Yeah, she was on one of those stupid shows.
Rusty needles are safe.
I believe it's Sharon needles.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, when I... these people, don't you have anything better to do than decide your little cause is going to be not vaccinating your child? That's how we became the first world.
Mm-hmm.
We vaccinated our children.
Yes. Yes. This is what she said. Oh, go ahead, I'm sorry.
I was just going to say that if you have a concern... Why is that what you're going to roll the dice on when the odds are so against you that something would go wrong?
Well, people have to share their lack of knowledge on Instagram.
Yeah, I think also people want to assume that their child is so special that, yeah I know the vaccines work for all the rest of your little water-headed children, but mine, you know, they're trying to get in on the herd immunity.
This is what she wrote. She said on Instagram, if you don't know what it's like to have the entire world openly criticize, judge, throw uninformed opinions and curse you, try being an openly pregnant vegan on Instagram, having a natural, drug-free home birth in water with a midwife and a doula. I don't know what a doula is, who has the intention of raising a vegan child without vaccinations. That's what she posted on Instagram.
Well, I think all that post is missing is that the midwife was actually a trans midwife. Then she would have covered all. Come on. Like, how do you post that bullshit and not get people coming after you?
Yeah.
What else could she have added to that? That it was on, it was fur free. I think, what else could you add to, like, then stop posting details of your stupid
Yeah,
life.
Yeah, yeah. You're spreading smallpox.
I seem to recall that when I was in school, they were constantly vaccinating us. I don't, looking back now, maybe, I don't know, maybe there is something to this, but you're getting the booster shots and you're getting rubella was a big thing. And
yeah. Her name is Catherine von Drachenberg.
Already that's making me think more. I want her medical advice. It sounds like a James Bond villain, von Drachenberg.
These are some of the diseases that Kat Von D is spreading. Hepatitis B, polio, diphtheria, lockjaw.
Yeah, all recent diseases, huh? No. We had them on the ropes. Thanks, Kat Von D.
Yeah. Pertussis. Polio.
Pertussis is a whooping cough.
Yeah. And pneumococcal disease. What's pneumococcal? Is that pneumonia?
I think so. That actually replaced the old cockal disease. And I actually have suffered from something similar when I get very sentimental. I have warm my cockles disease. That's usually around the holidays.
Measles?
Yeah. Is mumps in there?
Mumps?
Yeah.
No.
And German measles, rubella.
Yeah.
Take that, Germans. We just named some measles after you.
We call them freedom measles during World War II. Dermatologists say using toothpaste on zits can dry out the skin. This is from Daily Mail Online.
Is now, that good or bad?
I don't know, but the British are using toothpaste on zits, and they're being warned not to do that.
Yeah, is the warning include, why don't you try brushing your teeth with that? Look, you chimps, it's called toothpaste for a reason. Get some fluoride in there, you. Oh, God.
That's why their teeth look good. They've been brushing their teeth with Clearasil.
Yeah, they've got combination teeth.
Do you know where pimples come from? By the way, I've been told when I was first doing stand up in San Francisco, Will Durst told me never talk about acne or pimples on stage.
Why is that?
He just said you cannot get a laugh talking about pimples.
No, that's not.
It's one of the rules. Do you have any pimple jokes? Ever done jokes about acne or pimples?
I do have a reference or two. I've always maintained that if I had in high school, if I had been a pizza face, I wouldn't have made it. That would have put me over the edge.
Yeah.
In addition to all the other wonderful things they had going for me. But that would have been the zit that broke the camel's back.
Suppose it was deep dish pizza face. That's kind of... Do they get those in Chicago? The kids in Chicago get that. I'm from New York. You know, when I moved to California, I kept saying, you can't get a good pizza face here.
it's the water. about the zits, it shows you again, Will Durst, one of a great comic and one of the real smart guys. He was doing smart comedy when it wasn't real popular. It shows you how much we've changed. You had Will Durst and saying, no, zits aren't funny. And now you have YouTube channels of people popping zits.
Oh, my God.
And I can't get enough of them. You have to watch.
Really?
It's people with there's the whole zit popping channels, but
seriously,
and they'll pop these giant zits where it just keeps coming out of them. And I know it's so gross, but there's a real feeling of catharsis when you watch them. You feel like you've been through you watch them and you get like, and you start clenching up, and then they clean out the wound, and you're good to go about your day.
Yeah, but you're not supposed to pop your zits.
Well, when you see some of these, they're ones that should have been popped years ago.
I thought, like, if you pop is, by the way, people, I just know that people are getting pissed off that we're talking about this.
Why?
I just think.
Talk to me so we can have discussions that 14-year-old boys usually have.
I thought that if you pop a zit, it leaves a scar.
That's what they said, but that's also said by the people who are not walking around with your zits on their face. So I'd say do what they do in Britain. Put a little toothpaste on your spotty. I think they call it spotty. Mm-hmm. Your spotty face there. And while you're in England, take some dental floss and use that to tear off a genital wart. Instead of sticking any of that stuff in your face where it belongs.
Uh-huh. Now, anal warts, I want to get them whitened. Can you recommend some strips that I can put on my anal warts?
I recommend some of those snack strips we were talking about earlier in the podcast. Go for Irish Pale. That's the whitest one you can get.
Irish
Pale. Wow, we really, that's a deep cut. It's a callback and a deep cut.
Beyond the Pale. Do you know where that comes from? Dublin. That's a term that comes from Pale is a part of Dublin.
Really?
Yeah, and
when they say beyond the pale, it means it's past the pale. I think it's a river or a district in Dublin. And so when they say that's beyond the pale, it means it's above Dublin. Huh. We don't understand it.
Yeah, I'll have to run that past Jim Gaffigan, because he had a special called Beyond the Pale.
Yeah. Well, pale, that's interesting. Did he mention that the word pale is from Dublin?
No. Okay. I think he just did a joke.
Let's get him on the phone and tell him that.
Yeah, he's got a lot of free time.
I'm sure he does. Always use a fresh tea towel. Next time you dry your dishes with a tea towel, do you have a tea towel?
I don't even know what a tea towel is. Is that the one that's got the testosterone in it and you just swab it on yourself? You...
Repeatedly using an old tea towel spreads food poisoning, according to scientists. According to scientists, they found that half the towels they analyzed contained E. coli.
Mm. All right. Just how versatile did they think this tea towel was?
It's pretty frightening. Half your tea towels have the E. coli bug on them.
So I guess that's what we would call a dish towel here in the colonies.
Yes.
That's true, though, because I have a friend who told me that you should take your sponges and put them in the microwave every now and then to kill the bacteria. She meant contraceptive sponges. This was a while ago, so I took that as a bit of an affront. At this point, like, the world is full of germs. That's what the world is.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I make sure that I try to remember to wash my dish towels, because that's the kind of thing where once it's dry, you figure, it's been through the purification process, the rigorous process of me putting on a hook behind the dish rack and waiting.
Mm-hmm. How long do you keep a sponge? For example, do you use the same sponge to wipe the kitchen counter as you do to scrub a pot?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah, and you know what? Every time I go to do dishes, I had a huge pile of dishes last night, and as soon as I start doing the dishes, I think, I got to change the sponge. But I don't.
So you use the same sponge for the countertop that you do for, like, your silverware?
But for, like, a wipe of the countertop, not for a scrub of the countertop.
Mm-hmm.
That's different. I mean, I don't use it when I'm spraying, disinfectants and stuff like that.
Now, I don't have a dishwasher.
Me neither.
Yeah, mine is broken, and I just don't. I just figure, you know what? Why bother?
I don't even use dishes. I just eat standing naked over the sink.
Did I interrupt you?
That's one of the things I think of when friends of mine say, "You're so lucky you're not married," and I just immediately picture me naked, standing over the sink, eating, food that I stole from a green room.
Now, did you see Justin Trudeau's press conference where his eyebrows looked like they had been glued on and they were slipping from the sweat? Did you see that?
I haven't seen the video, but I saw people talking about it online, and I thought, well, they must be exaggerating. Then I saw the photo and thought it had been Photoshopped, but yeah, what? Does he not have eyebrows, and why did one of them fall off? That's like something you see on The Muppet Show.
It looked like his eyebrows were going off his face. Maybe he doesn't have eyebrows, or he's auditioning for the role of David Ferry in JFK 2. Joe Pesci played David Ferry in JFK. Do you remember David Ferry? He had no hair and no eyebrows.
He was like a very androgynous kind of guy, right?
Well, he was gay. Yeah. And he was having gay sex with Clay Shaw, who Kevin Costner in JFK says orchestrated the assassination, and they were having these wild parties in Louisiana. And David Ferry used monkey fur to create a wig and eyebrows, because he had, what's it called?
Oh, did he have alopecia?
Alopecia. Yeah, he had alopecia. Maybe Justin Trudeau has alopecia. Or he wants to kill Kennedy again.
It just seems like a strange part of your body to give way that. I can understand if a fake mustache fell off, but I don't know what was making. Maybe people were the things he was dealing with were so shocking that someone said this is going to raise a few eyebrows. Is that the kind of thing when you go back to the doctor and he recommends stop making arch comments, stop being ironic. Look what it's doing to you. It's killing you. That John Belushi impression, you're a death story.
The press conference started. He looked unctuous. By the time it was over, he looked supercilious, is what you're saying.
Yes, that is the range of symptoms.
Eyebrows are very expressive. Do you do cartooning?
No, but I've seen when you don't have eyebrows, it's a huge loss as to the expression, you know, the emotion the person convey.
All right. Stormy Daniels has a lawyer named Michael Avenatti. And he doesn't like Rudolph Giuliani because did you hear what Rudy Giuliani said about Stormy Daniels?
I don't know, but Rudy really seems to be freestyling in this press conference. Like right off the bat, it's like, are you trying to sound crazier than Trump?
Yeah. This is what he said about Stormy Daniels, and it makes me wonder. He said something. If you're a feminist and you support the porn industry, you should turn in your credentials. Is he right? Because feminists are calling Stormy Daniels a hero. Liberals are calling her a hero, and she's a sex worker. And it just want to know if it's okay to celebrate a porn star.
I think people tend to pick very strange idols and very strange martyrs. They've mm-hmm. gotten themselves locked into an ideology where I guess there was a point at which pornography was liberating for women. You could make
it was liberating
argument.
For me.
Yeah,
it was liberating for that guy on the Southwest flight.
Yeah, look at him; he's fancy free.
Can you stop liberating that and put it back in your pants?
Yeah, that's what I usually like to say at my pillow talk. I'm going to liberate the shit out of you. Oh, this is I'm calling this Operation Hotel Room Democracy. Yeah, so I think that, in a way, is a bit of a scam. I think there were a couple of sleazy dudes who thought they could, let's try and sell this as liberating for the women. Just like, apparently, you can connect this to the women who think flashing your tits is a bold gesture that's going to horrify the men you're against.
Yeah, burn your bras, ladies. That'll show them.
Yeah, the way you're walking around braless, that's going to change my vote.
Yeah.
So I think, I don't know, I saw Stormy Daniels on TV just, I guess, about 2 weeks ago, and she gave a very quick comment to the press, and she looked like she was just about had it. She looked like she was ready to break. Mm-hmm. So I don't think she's much of a hero for anything. I think she's someone who is just trying to get a payday. Whether she's earned it or not, that's a different story, but I don't see her as a good model for anything other than a personal greed.
Right. So Rudy said to Anderson Cooper, mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I don't respect a porn star the way I respect a career woman or a woman of substance or a woman who isn't going to sell her body for sexual exploitation, he said.
Well, pretty coherent for what he's been putting out lately.
Not that I agree with him. But,
I don't disagree with someone who has that point of view. I can't say that that's wrong. It's not what I would say, but.
Right. I wouldn't say it either. And I would.
You know what? I think it's because let's take a look at the porn industry. It is not healthy for people. You very rarely come out of that unscathed or even intact. If you look at the rates of suicides and the rates of drug abuse and. Just, I mean, come on. Let's not.
It's not something not I. It's not something I would wish for my daughter or your.
Yeah,
daughter.
You're not going to recommend that. So right. Yeah, it's not a good lifestyle. And I realize, and I say this to someone who, who consumes pornography. But hey, you consume the pornography? Does the pornography consume you? Because it pulls in a lot of bad behavior around it.
Chocolate layer cake is delicious, but let's not pretend it's good for you. Yeah, so Michael Avenatti is upset because his client has been called a lowlife, and he wants to prove, he's asking people to provide evidence that Rudy Giuliani watches porn.
Oh, well, God.
Here's evidence. A picture of Rudy Giuliani. Of course he watches porn.
What do we need to see footage of him jerking off on a Southwest flight? Is that what you really want?
Can you not look at porn? I mean, in terms of, it's just, it's everywhere, right?
Yeah, and it comes to you now. It's you can't avoid it.
Don't you think the Pope has seen, I don't mean to be rude, I know you're a practicing Catholic, but don't you think the Pope has seen porn?
Well, first of all, I'm no longer a practicing Catholic because I think I got it down now. Just do it from instinct. I don't know. I mean, remember, until not too long ago, they made the claim that the Pope was so infallible he didn't even shit.
Did they really say that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Forget.
That was the big question. Does the Pope shit in the woods and is a bear Catholic?
Yeah. Or, well, they really used to say that if he was so infallible, he would not have bowel movements. So that, I would say, if you're coming from that point of view, the Pope has certainly never seen German porn.
Wait a sec. To me, at my age, if he's infallible, he would have bowel movements.
Yeah, then he'd just be showing off.
Yeah.
They'd be so light and fluffy. They're like little clouds.
Before you go, great job there, Mr. DeVito.
Thanks.
You're a genius. You're a genius. Michael Rotundo, 30. Remember him?
Yeah, he's the 30-year-old guy whose parents sued.
Yeah, he was living with his parents, and they couldn't get him out of the house, so they had to take their kid. They had to take their 30-year-old son to court to get him to move out.
Yeah.
And he finally moved out.
Yeah, I think his legal argument was, well, I've been here this long without contributing or paying, so a precedent had been set. Which is, I think you could also use that if you were an adult who wished to still breastfeed off your mother. That's the precedent that would have said. Well, at one time, you did breastfeed me, so, yeah.
By the way, there's another, this is in Syracuse.
Mm-hmm.
And I was reading, there are two Michael Rotundos in Syracuse.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a usual name, I mean, right? That's
no, that was actually up in the Rotundo district of Syracuse. They have an outdoor fair this time of year. There actually was a Mike Rotundo who was a World Wrestling Federation, World Wrestling Entertainment character.
Really?
Although I don't. Yeah, he won the tag team title with Kerry Windham, but he also did. You know, sometimes, I don't know if you follow wrestling, but they'll just have someone be a different character. And he was Irwin R. Scheister, IRS. He was an evil tax accountant. For real. That was Mike Rotundo. I don't know if he spelled it differently, but so.
Irving Scheister?
Yeah, I think it was Irwin R. Scheister. Uh-huh. Well, yeah, think about that. Now, that's great. Why not just have a character they call Jew-Boy? You know, the one who's taking all your money. Oh, they come in and he would actually take money from people in the audience to get that a nice anti-Semitic storyline.
Are there Jewish? Hold it. Not The Rock. There's one. Goldberg, right?
Goldberg, yeah. Which one do you think back now that people were chanting Goldberg? It's pretty crazy.
Yeah, a Jewish wrestler. Yeah. I don't have a joke. I wish I did.
Okay, I waited there for you.
Yeah, I'm waiting. It's too early in the morning, but I know there's something there.
Yeah. Well, there was.
Yeah.
What, are you pulling a Dennis Miller on us now? In 3 weeks, you'll have a Goldberg joke.
Hang on. Come on. Jewish wrestler there. Nothing?
It's still on me? Come on.
My listeners, I know. I can't.
He hits you with a matzo ball. He circumcises you. I don't know. Look, haven't I done enough for you people?
When he throws a chair at you, there's a
that
little.
It has a bride sitting on it.
Oh, that's good.
All right.
I was going to say it has a plaque that says donated by Miriam Levinson. Well, the Rotundos got rid of their son. He called 911. The guy's a jerk. Somebody called him on the phone and said, mm-hmm. you're a loser, and then hung up. So Rotundo called 911 to complain about a phony phone call.
Yeah.
And then he called 911 on his father because he said that his son's Legos were in the basement. And he's 30 years old. He's living with his parents, and he's got a son.
Yeah.
And he couldn't find his son's Legos, and his father wouldn't let him go into the basement to look for his son's Legos. So he called 911.
Were they his son's Legos? I think they might have been his Legos.
Mm-hmm.
I think so. He is a new category of, I guess he's trans-ageist, because he's an adult man with a child who acts like he is a child.
Mm-hmm.
So he's calling 911. Did he also call Child Protection Services to make sure he stayed in the house, that he was not removed from the house?
That is white entitlement. I don't think many black people call 911 because their father won't let them look for their son's Legos.
Yeah, I can't imagine that. That's a frequent call in one of the Bronx precincts.
Yeah.
Is Laquan on the phone again? Yeah. You know, and I'm not saying that black people don't have similar family experiences, but you're right. They're not saying, let's get the authorities involved.
Mm-hmm.
Let's call the cops. That'll work out in our favor.
Well, Joe DeVito, thank you once again. It's always a pleasure. How do people contact you?
They can go to joedevito.com or follow me on Twitter and Instagram. It's at Joe DeVito Comedy.
Stay on the line for 1 second, sir. If you're enjoying today's show, please share it on Facebook, Twitter, StumbleUpon, Dig, Reddit. Copy and paste the link to this show and share it with all your friends via email. Spread the laughs, spread the knowledge, spread the love. Berg joins us in Astoria, Queens. I don't hear the birds.
We did some cleaning of the yard area and took all the wildlife. There we go. There's the goddamn, that bird is the Ford F-150 horn. You could hear that all through the interstate, the turnpike area, and places where white is right.
There
were birds earlier. I don't know why they silenced themselves. I think because they picked up on the anxiety that was coming in over the phone. Birds are very aware of anxiety.
Do you want to get a pet? Do you think a pet would make your wife happy? You have a baby now. How old is the baby? About a year?
9 months and several days.
Okay.
Yes, we have a pet. We have a support animal.
Ah. What kind?
A 6.5-pound Chihuahua rescue dog.
Oh.
He's a support animal. He takes on all of your emotional stress.
Is it officially a support animal, or is that just what you call it?
He's registered with the government. You know, when you register a service animal and you go to an apartment and they're like, no pets allowed, you can move in with the service animal and they'll be like, hey, I said no pets. And you go, it's a service animal, retard. And you throw this card at them and then they can't do anything. You're allowed to take it in there. They, even if they go, oh, there's no pets allowed, it's illegal. You could sue them. I'll sue everybody. I'm just looking to sue people.
Well, you know, I can't. I'm glad you told me that, because when I look for an apartment, I'm registered with the government, and that's why they won't rent to me.
Why? Oh, because you did the thing. Lollipop, lollipop, get in my van right now. Lollipop, lollipop, suck on the lollipop. Lollipop, lollipop, whoops, it doesn't go in there. Lollipop. Don't tell your parents, lollipop, lollipop, here is a comic book, lollipop, lollipop, just forget this happened, please, lollipop, lollipop, don't tell them I was soft for most of it, lollipop, I'm not a man now. Call these children lollipop, tell you why.
All right.
That's an oldie but a goodie.
You know, Rick Overton, the comedian, his mother was one of the singers on that song.
Come on.
Swear to God.
Let me tell you about Rick Overton. Saw him years ago at Yuck Yucks. Thought he was brilliant. He had this great bit about you'd be at the gym and you'd be looking at guys and you'd be like, it's not gay. I'm just comparing myself to them. and now he's on what I think is probably the most brilliant TV show out there, which is I'm Dying Up Here
on
Showtime. And he plays Carson's Booker on that.
Yeah. Jim Carrey. Is the producer.
Jim Carrey produced it. He's gone batshit bananas.
Now, when you go to the gym, because I belong to a gym, and do you walk around with a towel around your privates when you're in the sauna, or do you just let it all?
I go towel in the privates, and I also I'll quote the Bible when I'm in the sauna, and I go, Jesus said that the homosexuality was wrong, and Jesus said that you should only fornicate for the purpose of procreation, and God made man in his image, and that image was to fornicate with women, and the vagina is sanctimonious. And if you come closer to me, you will not get a wedding cake, and I will put up a sign and say that you cannot buy tools in my store. But the problem is, I'm fully erect.
That's a great idea. Oh, you're fully erect.
Yeah, so it confuses people because the towel is there, but you can see it's throbbing under the towel. So it throws people off.
Because you're so heterosexual.
Yeah, that Jesus gets me all erect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What a great way for privacy in the gym. If you want to empty out a jacuzzi, a sauna, the swimming pool, just stand there and preach the gospel. And according to the Supreme Court, you have religious freedom now.
Yeah.
They can't throw you out of the gym. So people will leave you alone.
What if I went in with a whole bunch of Hanukkah candles strapped to my chest and I yelled, Allahu Akbar! And they're like, this guy's really confused. And then I just break into a smile and go, Simen nuffin, muzzle tuffin, muzzle tuffin. And then I pick up a chair and just start holding the honorary bar mitzvah ghost up in the air. And I go, the ghost of bar mitzvah pass! There's so many religions you can mix together.
How many days a week do you go to the gym?
5.
Because you're like buff, man.
Yeah, I look good, but I'm not, you know, I smoke a lot of cigars, so my endurance is that of 12.8 seconds now.
You go to the gym 5 days a week.
Yeah.
And you rotate the muscles, right? You do the upper body one day, the lower body the other day.
Here's the plan. You go in. On Mondays, you blow a guy named Raul. Next day, you go in, you work your calf muscles a little bit. You do anal with a guy named Steven. Wednesday, you got to work forearms. So what you do, there's these two guys that look Mexican, but they're Puerto Rican. You jack them both off in the parking lot, and it's a contest. And you keep saying, andale, andale, until one of them comes real quick. The next day, you got to train lower body. So what you do is you get pounded just by a squash racket. There's a guy that works there that for $15 will hold the butt end of a squash racket. Mm-hmm. And then on the final day, you got to work the core. So what you do is you hold your neck up and gargle semen while singing all right, all right. How I Love You, Swanee.
Okay. All right.
And then I do cardio sometimes.
You do cardio.
Yeah.
And you're strong, right?
Yeah, I'm pretty strong.
And what evidence? Do you ever, like, say to yourself, man, I'm strong? Do you ever look in the mirror and go, God, I'm strong? Or do you ever pick something up? Or when do you realize you're strong?
I realized once there was, like, a big guy that kind of shoved me. And then I shoved him back, and I was aware. And he was, like, you know, much taller than me and much bigger than me. And I remember just kind of like throwing him across the room. And then I was like, oh, I'm strong. I forget that sometimes because I'm so sensitive and aware most of the time, you know, and just really a good person.
Has anybody ever messed with you on stage? Have they ever?
Yeah, I was at Greenwich Village Comedy Club and someone walked up on the stage and I go, get off the stage. And the guy just stared at me. So I threw him into the seats.
Really?
Yeah. And then I felt bad because my Jew kicked in. And I was like, I'm very sorry. I didn't mean that. I feel I have anger issues. And I started explaining the whole thing. And then this guy was such a douche that he's like, yeah, that guy assaulted me. I don't want to pay my bill. So he got a free bill. I shouldn't have apologized. That's a lesson. Never apologize for a joke or for throwing someone at chairs.
I think you're right.
Yeah.
I think
what about you? You ever go off on somebody? You get people that yell at you.
You know, I don't mean to jinx it, but nobody's ever come at me.
Wow.
Yeah. I think because I'm so offensive.
Yeah.
That they just don't respect me enough to actually attack.
I don't know. It's an exhilarating feeling. Your heart starts racing because you're like, oh. And then party is like the club I was at, there was no security. So usually there's security that would deal with something like that. But then I was like, oh, I'm just going to throw this guy off the stage. And it was a great feeling. It was street justice.
Have you ever been on the street looking for justice?
Yeah.
Justice Gomez. He's a...
Justice Gomez is a male stripper that mm-hmm. used to work at this club called Flesh Penis. He continues to claim he was straight, but I saw him do stuff. And he goes, no, it's not gay if there's money. So what he would do is all the time, I saw him once at a rest stop, and he's just getting pounded. And I go, Justice? And real quick, he reached in his pocket and pulled a dollar out. And he's like, look, look. And I was like, ah, okay. Justice go. I talked to my friend Johnny Thor yesterday, by the way. You remember him? I brought him up on your show. And so I asked him, I go, how's it going? Are you taking your testosterone? Because I told him to get on testosterone because he's like almost 60. So he took testosterone and then he sent me pictures of himself, which were naked. So I had to figure out for 30 minutes, had to delete these pictures off my phone. So I didn't have naked pictures of a ripped man on my phone that wasn't me.
In your book, Modern Etiquette for, what is it called?
Mr. Manners, Proper Etiquette for the Modern Degenerate.
Yes. What is the etiquette for being in a locker room with other men?
Maintain a lot of eye contact, but don't maintain too much eye contact. You know, you want to not be looking at people's dicks. Don't do that. And you'll see different dicks because they come in different. There's all different dicks. You think your dick is the only one. But it probably looks all sad and there's a little kippa on the tip of it. And then a kippah, you know, a yarmulke. Mm-hmm. You probably on the somehow you've taped to the hole, maybe a picture of your family. There's a little school bag near your nuts. I understand what you do.
My pubes are like Talit.
Yes, like Talit. Yeah. I don't know if, you know, not all dicks look as sad as yours. And then you don't want to go in the gym and be like, oh, hey, nice dick, bro. You can't say that. Because even though it's a bro generation, you can't do that. And sometimes I'll be like, oh, man, you look cut. And your glutes look awesome. I wish I was inside them. And it's like, you have to know when is too much. So the locker room is a very, look, there's a lot of gay men in the locker room. There's no two ways about it. There is no two ways about it. A lot of gay men, but some people are straight and will be offended when you say stuff like, hey, nice nuts, can I put them in my mouth? Or hey, how do you get your shithole that ripped?
And, okay, all right. So the marriage is going well?
Yeah, everything's good. She was away in Philadelphia for a day.
And you still love the baby?
Baby's great. Slept with the baby last night. She loves when I sleep with her. And, you know, you're not supposed to sleep in the bed with her, but we say, you know, what do these people that have had babies before know? It's not like they've had babies. So we just don't listen to their logic. And I told my wife, I go, you're spoiling her. And she goes, so she'll be spoiled. For David, she would tell me, she goes, we're not going to spoil this baby. We're not going to spoil this baby. My wife is incredibly spoiled. She has one fur coat to wipe her ass with after a bidet. So I go, we're not going to spoil it. So now she goes, well, I guess she'll be spoiled then. And, you know, when you have a daughter, you want to spoil her.
So yeah.
Yeah.
That's the point of having a daughter.
It's to spoil her.
It's to spoil her. But you can't spoil a 9-month-old.
Yeah, letting her sleep in the bed, you're creating habits. If she sleeps in the bed all the time, then she's going to continue to want to sleep in the bed all the time.
But it's delicious. Does the Chihuahua sleep in the bed too?
Sometimes. The Chihuahua sneaks in. We try not to let the Chihuahua sneak in.
What's the Chihuahua's name?
Mijo.
Hmm.
It's Spanish for legal. I have paperwork.
Okay. Now, do the Canadians have a dog? Like, when we think of Mexico, we think of Chihuahuas.
Yes.
Is there a dog that is emblematic of Canada?
Yes, it's called the Pussycat. Canada's in big trouble, David. I don't know if you've been following this, but they are in big, big trouble. I know you love Canada.
I do.
I know I'm from Canada, but there are big problems going on. You heard about this... John Chrétien's son, the prime minister.
I thought it was...
Yeah, I know. I changed the name to see if you'd catch it.
Chrétien?
Trudeau. Chrétien was like...
He was a liberal prime minister, right? Green Party?
He choked a man. Do you remember that? He choked a man.
Who was Chrétien?
Chrétien was a prime minister that choked a man. He was very French, and he had this face that looked somewhat retarded. It looked like he had a stroke, and he would talk like this. He would be like, the Canada is a very good place, and blah, 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 blah. Very French. Mm-hmm. And then one interviewer was like, excuse me, Mr. He goes, you shut the tabernacle up. And he grabbed him by the neck, and he started choking him. And he goes, I don't care about you. But now the big news is Justin Trudeau, after all... Canada really wants to be America. I don't know if you know this or not. Do you know this?
I don't know why they would want that, but...
Because they think America is so cool, so sexy. And then what happened was they want to be America, so they make fun of our president. I don't know if you know. Our president has weird hair. You mm-hmm. follow our president a little bit. You've probably mm-hmm. noticed it. It stands yes. out a bit. They make fun of his hair all the time. Now it turns out their prime minister wears fake eyebrows.
I saw that.
Yeah.
Now, is that true?
Sure. It's not a doctored photo. Everybody shared it. Real legit news websites like JewsWillNotReplaceUs.com. I read it on there. I read it on The Daily Stormer. I read it on nblack.org. I read it on FergusonEffect.ca. I read it on policeareinnocent.com. I read it on all these important websites, so don't tell me it's fake. I saw it on CNN, which is just like CNN, but way more truthful.
And more ends.
Yeah, and it stands for now. It's crazy what's happened in politics now.
Oh, I think I have a joke.
Really?
Fox News is so racist, they should call it CN-word. CNN-word.
That's funny.
Is it funny?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
That's going to kill when you open for the Amish comic in Vermont.
Sorry, I'm talking too much today. I apologize.
I put a video up on Instagram. There's an Amish comic. Have you heard of this Amish comic? I'm all over the place today. Amish comic. So I did a video of me as an Amish comic. I go, I heard there's an Amish comic. So here's me as an Amish comic. I was doing it with my wife, and she said, "Ye shall not, ye shall not come on my chest." And so then I did it a month ago, and then the Amish comic responded to my Instagram yesterday, wow. And he goes, "It loses a little something without the hat." Because he wears a hat. And I go, what a funny Amish comic. When
churn
he reads
it.
This.
Churn yeah. it till there's butter.
Oh.
Is oh, he really boy. Amish?
Yeah, he's Amish. He's not going to read his Instagram for another 6 months till he gets near electricity.
What is social media like among the Amish?
I think one guy goes, "Did you hear my wife, Kathy, got 2 likes on her butter?" And then he goes, "I'll pass it on. And I'll go tell Jebediah and Henrik." And then he comes back and he goes, "Now it's up to 4 likes and 1 comment. The comment was, help us raise the barn and stop blibber blabbering about your butter."
Do you have Amish people in Canada? Do you have the Shakers?
No, there's not Amish people, but there's someone like Amish people. They have a different name. I forget what it is. Comish? Yeah.
So the Canadians don't have like a national dog. Is there a favorite dog in Canada?
Mm.
And don't say Kim Campbell.
They don't like pit bulls. They ban pit bulls in some provinces.
That's not nice.
They're not fans of pit bulls, David. They're, you know, they say pit bulls eat babies. They stand by that. And here in America, people give pit bulls a chance.
They're sweet dogs, pit bulls.
When they're eating babies. They're so cute. You're like, oh, look how cute that baby is going in that pit bull.
No.
I don't know. You like pit bulls?
They're very sweet animals. I don't think you should have one if you have a small child, but they're less likely to attack you than most dogs. They're very gentle. They just have big snouts. Their mouths can really grab you.
Yeah, or a baby.
Or a baby.
Yeah, they love babies. Like, they look at babies and they're like, oh, that's better than a greenie treat. You know those little greenie treats I give my dog? I'm like, you want a greenie? If you say that to a pit bull, they're like, maybe, but do you have a baby? And then if you say, you want a baby? Pit bull's like, pit bulls get so happy to eat babies. I don't know why.
That's not true.
Let me ask you this.
Yes, sir.
When you have a baby and then you look at this baby and you see it, it's full of potential and life, and then you know that at some point in time your child's going to have to go through heartbreak or difficult times. How do you console yourself, or how do you prepare yourself for these moments? Like when you had, like, I know you've been divorced 46 times and you used to bed yourself in many four ways with ladies, men like Liberace, but like, How do you prepare yourself for this?
That somebody's going to hurt your baby emotionally.
Yeah.
And especially a daughter.
Mm-hmm.
You just try to love your children unconditionally. You give them so much love that they're strong enough to survive the cruel world out there.
Yeah,
you know, you just have to tell your daughter you love her every day. Every day. No matter what. Unconditional love. Are you capable of unconditional love? Are you capable of loving somebody just because they're somebody?
Yeah, I mean, I do it now, but, you know, she hasn't given me reason not to yet.
Yeah. I think comedians are accustomed to conditional love, which is why we go on stage, because we're used to, you know, the sliding scale. We're used to the line constantly moving when it comes to love. It's not healthy.
No, it's not healthy. But is that where drugs and alcohol come in?
Yeah, I would recommend drugs and alcohol for your daughter.
Yeah, we've already been doing that. She's on this new antidepressant called Dadacil, which helps her deal with her father's anxiety. It's they have it in droplet form so that you can just put it in the baby's butt. And I don't know if I read the bottle right, but we have Dadacil and then we have Mama Bagacil, which deals with mother baggage that is obviously related to her father issues. So it seems like it's working out well. Everything's great. How's life with you? I'm up for the housing lottery.
What does that mean?
It means if we qualify, we can get an apartment in Manhattan for a fraction of the cost of what it would usually cost.
Now, this is the work of de Blasio. This is who runs it?
These are called the Giuliani houses. They've been set up midtown. You can tell because there's big stormtroopers out front. Then there's these waving flags, somewhat reminiscent of 1941 Germany. But the houses seem great. I just had to sign off on some paperwork, said I'd never met a woman named Daniels. I don't know. But it seems like a good thing. And they're basically like the bottom floors are being rented out for peep shows. Then the next couple floors, we don't know what happens, but basically the elevators say no matter what, the police are right. So I don't know what those floors 2 to 4 are. Then above that we would be residing in the Yehuden Street. It's a lovely place. There is no, I don't know what Yehudin is. I think it's, but it also, this, for some reason, we have these armbands we have to wear to the interview. But I think it's because I work in show business, because it's a big, bright yellow star. Which is exciting that they recognize me. They must have seen me somewhere. Maybe my DirecTV commercial. And then we do that. And then it's the building was clearly built by Asians because there's no 13th floor and it smells like mothballs. So the 14th floor is the one they take out. That's bad, as they say, ruck. I don't know why they say rock, but we say luck, but they go 14. It's a bad ruck. And the back they're putting, which is going to be great if you, there's a Starbucks. So sometimes we don't even need to go in our apartment. We can just sleep in the Starbucks or, you know, shoot smack, do whatever we want. My favorite game now is I go into Starbucks. Ooh, there's a plane coming overhead. I go in Starbucks and I just go, and they go, what can I get for you? I go, some fucking heroin and a bathroom key. I go, a good vein in between my toes and a clean needle. How the mighty have fallen, you bougie corporation. Remember, you were charging everybody $8 for a whipped latte, and now there's some guy shitting his pants back there while singing Elvis songs like that? Bright light city, gonna set my soul, you're gonna set my soul on fire. I got a whole lot. Oh, God. Fucking fix me, man. Fix me. Oh, Viva Las Vegas. Oh, Viva. Oh, man. It looks like peanut butter, man. Oh, Viva. Viva Las Vegas. Man, if my mama would have loved me, I never would have. Oh, God. I'm flying through the eye of the sun right now, man. Oh, Jesus H. Christ, I'm higher than I hope. Oh, Viva! Viva! Thank you, Starbucks. I'll be back. Oh, man.
Hey, he's running for president.
Who is? Elvis?
Schultz, Howard Schultz, the founder of Starbucks.
Come on.
Yeah. He stepped down as CEO or chairman, and he's doing an exploratory committee, and he's going to run for president.
Is he Jewish?
Schultz?
Yes.
Is Schultz a Jewish name?
Could be. You tell me.
Well, the guy from Hogan's Heroes.
Sounds German.
Sounds German.
I'm out. I'm not buying. I ain't buying. I'm not buying what you're selling. I don't need one of these Polsky Ogorsky eating Nazis coming up in here with their sauerkraut, and they're just riding the Trump wave to the next level, taking these neo-Nazis, making them real-o Nazis. That's the next level. After Neo, you go real-o. Neo is like kind of fake. Real-o is, you don't get realer than that. And I don't need Nazis around.
Now, weren't you in a Disney movie called Finding Neo?
Yeah, Finding Neo. It was like I played this fish that went, and it was basically like a History Channel mashup where I went to all these little places like Brazil and hunted down these old men that thought they got away with stuff. And I'd slit their throats, watch the blood pour out, and then I'd look for fillings in that blood. And I'd be like, nope, this one's empty. And then I'd just let it die. They used to take the Jews' fillings. They weren't nice to the Jews. Jews have been through a lot. I don't know if you know this or not.
They used to take the fillings, the gold fillings.
What about the silver ones?
I guess, yeah.
It's sad what happened. That this thing called the, I was reading about it, it's called the hoe locust. And it was about these bugs that took over Germany that were very slutty. And these locusts would go all around Germany and just sleep with everybody, the hoe locusts. It was horrible. It's not a good look, man. I mean, you know, America's come a long way. Say what you want about indentured servitude, but it's come. Say what you want about this country being built on the backs of black America, but it's come a long way. I'll tell you that, a long way. Jews used to have slave songs. Do you know that?
No, but they were slaves in Egypt, so they must have had slave songs.
Hmm. Yeah, one of them was Oy vey. Oy vey. Oy vey. The sun is hot, Oy vey. The mortar's hot, oy vey. The pharaoh's a faggot, oy vey. Egypt blows donkeys, oy vey. Shoulda stayed in the desert, oy vey. My wife is a heifer, oy vey. Even though I sleep, I'm always tired, oy vey. Building pyramids is not good work. Building pyramids, oy vey, oy vey. Gonna jump down, turn around, oy vey, I'm tired. Jump down, turn around, oy vey, I'm spent. Jump down, turn around, oy vey, my back hurts. Jump down, turn around, should have been the lawyer. Oh, Lordy, hating building pyramids. Oh, Lordy, hate building them now. Oh, Lordy, let's start a law firm. Oh, Lordy, order with money. Gonna jump down, turn around, wait, I can't jump. Wait, I can't jump, or down, or turn around. Jump down, turn around, I'm not doing nothing. Jump down, turn around, I'll sit here while you do it. Oh, Lordy, don't want to move now. Oh, Lordy, I'm so exhausted. Oh, Lordy, my allergies are acting up. Oh, Lordy, do you have some sunscreen? Oh, Lordy. Jewish slave songs.
God.
It's a good time always. Monday mornings.
Aaron Berg. Hang on. Whew. How do people follow you on Twitter?
You can find me at Aaron Berg Comedy on Twitter.
What is the name of your CD?
Mr. Manners live from Long Island City.
And I understand your podcast is now 4 days a week.
podcast/video show will be 4 days a week starting July 9th on compoundmedia.com.
Wow. And where are you performing this weekend?
Well, this weekend I will be in the Adirondacks on vacation. I will be back. I'm going fishing. You should come up. It'll be wonderful. Just a guy's weekend. Just guys being guys, having sex with other guys. And no women to bring us down. Just full on anal. And first guy to prolapse gets to eat the bass we catch. And yeah, I'll be. But I'll be tonight.
Are you going? Are you going? Are you really going fishing?
Yeah, you should come.
Who do you go with?
Me and Gino Bisconti, my partner on my show in Hot Water.
And where do you stay?
I've rented a cabin and a fishing boat. It's a whole big to-do.
And just the two of you?
Maybe a couple other guys coming. I've got a friend named Justin Smith. I think he's going to come up.
No women?
No women. This is equality at its finest. My wife is going on a trip to Mexico, an all-inclusive sex vacation. That, I don't know. I was like, so what's that include? Drinks and food and what? And she's like, I don't want to talk about it. So she walked away. But she's going there for 4 days. I go, you get to go away with your friends. I get to go away with my friends. And then I realized they have no friends. So I just offer it to everybody.
Well, wait a second. Who's watching the baby?
The what? Ah, oh, Jesus, I forgot a little. Okay, let me. my wife's going to watch the baby while I'm away, and then I'll watch the baby while she's away in Mexico getting donged by a busboy as she uses her vagina as a coyote to guide someone into the country. Come this way, but it's so wet. No, okay. That's the right, Rio Grande.
All right. Okay, hang on. Stay on the line for 1 second. Enjoying today's show, please remember to do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the Amazon banner, click on it, and then shop away. We get a small percentage of everything you purchase. I promise you, every penny we get goes towards keeping the show going. And if you're doing your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website, hit the contact button. Let me know so I can thank you.